radio. Jesus loves you and he wants you to know. Choice Radio. Study his word so you can grow. Choice Radio.
Choice Radio. Your life, your salvation, your choice. Jesus is Lord.
Arise, 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 take your place, be enthroned on our
arise and face this brand new day, brethren. It has been granted to us. It was never promised, but it has been granted to us, and we receive it gladly as we thank the King for making it possible. Father, we bless you, we thank you, and we praise you for this new day you have given us, God. As we get out to do our daily duties, Father, we thank you for making it possible that we are a part of this day. We don't know what to say to you, God. We come humbly before you, asking you for the utterance, thanking you for the power of your Holy Spirit, Father, that you promise and have delivered to us, God. We bless your name today. We are grateful to be alive in the land of the living. We humble before no one else but you. You are God, and you are God alone. So, Father, go ahead and have your way in our lives today, God, as we gather around Choice Radio to hear what you're saying in the Spirit, God. We give you all praise, honor, and glory. You said if we lift you up, you will draw all men unto you, God. And this we pray, that men will be drawn to your word and the will of the one that you have sent, and not unto anything else, not unto me, not unto nobody else, but unto your son Jesus. the perfect sacrifice, Father. We thank you, Jesus. Father, have your way among us today. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen.
Lord, come and inhabit the praises of your people. How many of God's people do we have out there tonight? Sing this with me.
We lift you up. We lift you up. We lift you up on our praises.
Yeah.
We lift you up. We lift you up. We lift you up on our praises.
Come on.
We lift you up. We lift you up on our praises.
Yeah.
We lift you up. We lift you up. We lift you up on our praises.
We lift.
We lift you up. We lift you up. We lift you up on our praises.
Yeah.
We lift you up. We lift you up. We lift you up on our.
Mighty people, wake up and face the day. It is before us. We can't hide from it. Arise, mighty ones, and take your place this morning.
Let the light.
All right, indeed. All right, Satan, you can't win this one. This morning, you can't win. We up on deck. We ready for you. In the 15 minutes on the other side of the 7 o'clock. Good morning to your brethren out there in Radio Land. It's definitely Choice Radio, your life, your salvation, your choice. Amen. We are blessed to have you this morning. We thank God for Jesus. We're going to try to get that song situated. We give you praise this morning to our God. We thank him for saving us through the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. So we thank God for each and every one of you this morning. It's definitely a great pleasure to come here before you once again and just giving God thanks for what he has done in my life, as we all give him thanks every day for giving us the power to arise, amen, and face a brand new day. So good morning to you, all those on the phone lines, 213-493-0146. Good morning to you. We bless God for you. All those on the app, Choice Gospel Radio from your market, good morning. Hope you're in a good mood this morning, amen. Hallelujah. We bless God. All those on the website, www.choicegospelnetwork.com. Amen. We bless God for you this morning, and we thank you for taking the time on those of you who deliberately tune in to hear what's going on and just giving God praise with us and joining in with what we're doing here at Choice Radio. We definitely thank you for being a part of it. Amen. We bless God for Jesus. It's all about him, all about liberating the people through Christ Jesus. You have already paid that price. Amen. So arise, brethren. If you're getting out there for 8 o'clock, you just got to keep moving. You can't wait. Time waits for no man, woman, boy, or girl. Amen. So get it moving and carry your radio with you. Do the dial up, whatever it is necessary to keep you in touch with us right here at Choice Radio. And keep praying for us as you step out. Amen. Be blessed of the Lord, brethren. He's worthy of all our praises. Amen. All right. Let's do it one more time. All right. You feel like they're stopping your feet? You can do that. Just blessing you, God.
Yeah.
It's a rise in the morning. 21 minutes past the 7. The time is definitely moving this morning. Hope you're in a good mood this morning. We bless God for you. We are grateful to be alive. Grateful to be here. We pray that we all are humble ourselves before God this morning. As He's Almighty, He's All Great. Yes, indeed. Hey, my wife, good morning. How are you? Let's bless God for only what He can do. Promise your helpmate and delivered. I'm grateful, I'm thankful. Anoint me to be right in your sight with my wife. Indeed. All those thankful for their wives this morning. Not ashamed to thank God for what He has done. Amen. Bless God. Let's bless Him, the King. The King of all kings, brethren. Arise and shine before your God this morning. It's called Arise. Choice Radio, your life, your salvation, your choice. Ivor Stevenson, morning. All the family in Radio Land, all those praying for me, praying for us at Choice Radio. As we continue to lift up the name that is above every name, that name is Jesus. And He had paid the price for humanity, that they can come boldly before the throne of grace and receive mercy. Hallelujah. Yes, Jesus.
Come on, magnify His name.
Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. He's worthy indeed. The word of God said in Psalms 1, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doeth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of waters, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. We bless God. Hallelujah. We bless Him today. We thank Him for this great opportunity of life in the land of the living. Let's do it. As you keep moving, those on the roads, good morning to you. Wake with a sense of purpose this morning. Don't care what you're facing, know that God is with us.
God loves a lullaby in a mother's tears in the dead of night, better than a hallelujah sometimes. God loves a drunkard's cry, the soldier's plea not to let him down, better than a hallelujah sometimes. We pour out our miseries, God just hears a melody. Beautiful the mess we are, the honest cries of breaking hearts are better than a hallelujah. Of breaking hearts. than a hallelujah.
Better than hallelujah. The highest praise, it said. 27 minutes past the 7. Good morning. It's Bobo's morning. All those on the roads, all those with the trucks in their pocket, ready to do the Father's will today. Indeed, bless God for you as you keep moving. Amen. Thank you so much, guys. We love you so much in Radio Land. Those already in the jobs, good morning to you. Thank you. Open your heart to the word of God. There's so much in there for this generation. The Lord is saying so much. Let my people go. Set my people free that they can worship me. Hallelujah.
Your grace sufficient for my soul, and your love has never let me go. I would be nothing without you. The greatest thing I've done is give my life to you. So I lift my hands. With my soul I'll sing. You are my God, King of Kings, Emmanuel, my everything. No one is greater, greater, greater than you. Alpha, Omega, you're the same. My guiding line, you never change. I
Hallelujah. Bless his name. Let's give it all back to him this morning. As we thank him for another day in the land of the living, brethren. Let's pick up the big man, the king of all kings. Don't care how tough you are this morning. Don't care how much money in your pocket. Don't care how good looking you are this morning. He holds tomorrow. He holds today. He holds forever. Let's humble before him. If we don't humble to nobody else. Humble before the great God. I've heard too many stories, too many testimonies of our God and his greatness. And I want to be there. I want to see him face to face, up close. Yes, indeed. 24 minutes past 7 o'clock. It's going to rise. Good morning. Hey, Sister Anne-Marie, this one is for you. I know you love this one.
Lift your hands and just worship.
And all those that love this one.
He deserves the glory. He deserves the honor.
JW, morning to you, brother.
Come on, worship.
All the family praying for us. Pray for us, brethren.
Come on, open your mouth and let the Spirit just begin to flow out of you.
Yes, indeed.
My heart, my mind, my soul belongs to you. My love, my life, it all belongs to you. Belongs to you. Hey, hey, oh yeah. Belongs to you.
Come on and sing it with me. My heart, my mind, lift your voice and say. We'll be right back.
My mind, my soul belongs to you.
Indeed.
It belongs
to him. You were bought with a price this morning.
It all belongs to you.
Bless your God, brethren, wherever you are this morning.
It all belongs to you.
The Bible says, iron sharpened iron. We are here to sharpen each other. Amen. In the word of God. Yes, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
It all belongs to you.
We all call for a time and a season.
It all belongs
yes, indeed.
To you.
Yes, indeed. Wherever you are, wherever you are. Be proud this morning.
Breathe, Lord.
Yes.
Everything that we are, Lord.
Hallelujah.
It all belongs to you.
Mm-hmm.
It all belongs to you.
Hallelujah. Bless your name, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. You know my heart this morning. You know me and you know every one of us today. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's bless him this morning. There's a reading in here in the 2 Corinthians 5 and 17. I always quote it from there. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new, and all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation. To wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespass unto them, and had committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as to, through God did beseech you by us. We pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. For he had made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. The word of the Lord. As you step out, be an ambassador today. Be willing, be ready to share the word of God with somebody. Look for an opportunity. Look for an opening. And let them know Jesus loved them. Then spark the conversation. Speak in your own terms.
You ought to live.
It's not by your power,
God,
not by your mind, but by the Spirit of the Lord, you will be able to convey an important message to them today that will prick their heart. That seed will have been planted. Next man will water, and God will give the increase. All right, 42 minutes past the hour of 7 o'clock.
You ought to live so God can use you anywhere.
Wow, man. Live so that God can use you, brethren, as you step out. Any one of us and every one of us is capable of bringing millions to the kingdom of light. Amen. In the name of Jesus, with one word. You don't know who you can spark as you step out. You don't know who you can speak to that can come to Christ and therefore turn around and bring millions to the Lord. Amen. So be willing to be used by God as you step out. Amen. So he can use you. Amen. We bless God. We give him praise this morning. We thank him for another day in the land of the living. It's called Arise, brethren. If it's your first encounter, sit back, relax, wherever you are. Allow God to be with us as he asks us to try every spirit. Amen. Don't care what a spirit say, you try every spirit. Test it and see. Wait according to the word of God. Yes. And the fruits thereof. Hey, morning to all married people this morning.
I stand amazed in your presence. There is nothing you cannot do. I stand amazed in your presence. There is joy, peace, and hope. There's no one like you, Jesus. There's no one like you.
If you get in there for eight, don't be late. Get on. Wake up. Sleepy head.
Like you, Jesus. There's no one like you. You do mind. You do glory. You're a faithful God. Awesome is your.
He does it all the time, I'm telling you. You know, God is so amazing. You know, I always ask God, you know, like, you know, if I have anything against anybody or anybody, you know, whatever it is, I want to make sure I can meet them or give me the opportunity to meet them in the right way, the right place, and whatever to make it right. I always ask God, you know, whatever it is. And yesterday I was thinking about this lady when I came to America a long, long, long time ago. You know, she used to always, you know, bring me food and do different things. You know, a nice little lady, you know, I knew for a long, long time. And I think, you know, yes, I don't see this lady. I would just love to see this lady until I really appreciate her gestures and stuff like that and whatever it is. And, you know, my wife went somewhere and we came back in the car and we were driving. And as I turned the corner, there she was. Oh, my goodness. It was just a beautiful thing. So God is, I mean, I'm telling you, it was the perfect time. It was the perfect weather. It was the perfect breeze that was blowing. It was the perfect atmosphere. It was the perfect situation. So Jesus, we bless you today. You are always forever faithful. You do mighty things. Amen. Let's give him praise, brethren. Oh, God is awesome. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. So anybody out there in radio land, in the world, whatever it is, you want to make sure you're right with them and stuff like that, and something had happened in the past, whatever. Now you have come to Christ, you want to make sure you get it right. Hey, ask your God to give you the opportunity that you can make it clear, and also ask him for those who you might not even think about, that you might have transgressed against or done something wrong. I mean, you know what I mean? And let God give you have his way in your life. And let him speak to you. Resolve it. Get it right. Yeah, man. Hallelujah.
I stand amazed in your presence.
I stand amazed this morning, brethren.
There is nothing you cannot do.
Hallelujah.
I stand amazed in your presence. There is joy, peace, and hope. There's no one like you. There's no one like you. In all the end, there's no one like you, Jesus. There's no one like you. You do mind, you do glory. You're a faithful God, awesome is your. You
and wherever you're listening across the world, good morning to you. All the brethren far and wide, we thank you so much. Thank you for sharing Choice Radio. It's all about Jesus, brethren. It's all about the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. And I apologize to you. I gotta follow Jesus. I'm gonna follow the word of God as he delivers to me. I am responsible for my life, my soul, and my salvation. I can't join with the wicked. I'm sorry. He's awesome this morning, brethren. Let's bless the King this morning. Those who don't yet know Jesus, we have an obligation to make Jesus available to them. Hallelujah. We can't force them. But let's lay down the red carpet. All the way, the blood of Jesus has been shed. Oh, glory to his mighty name. I believe every word. Hallelujah. If you're getting there for 8, you gotta keep moving. It's gonna rise in the morning.
He's a good,
hallelujah.
So merry time. He's a good, so merry time. He's a good,
yeah.
Jesus is a good, so merry time. He's a good.
Right there. I'm gonna do it again. As we climb to the 8th, all the family in Christ, good morning. All the taxi drivers, good morning, brethren. God has been good, right? Yeah. Hey, like a morning to you, man. Jesus is the good Samaritan. Pastor Samuel, morning. Brother Edwin. He's a good Samaritan. And all the young men in Jesus. Yeah. He's a good Samaritan. Samaritan. He's a good. I didn't know many people know that what I'm saying about a lot of these things. They know it's true, but they just don't know how to deal with it. And we, you know, I guess they have some obligation to the pastor, to the church. Somebody gonna hear their voice. But brethren, what we have to concern about is the man who don't know Jesus and is held at bay because of man-made rules, man-made religion, man-made things that is inconsistent with the scripture. This is what you will have to deal with before your God. You knew better, and you stood there and allowed him to do it. You allowed him to do it. You dabbled in the blood of those who are not saved and have not received Jesus, the one who paid it all. You stood there as a witness, and you witness against those who don't know Jesus. What do you have to say? To whom much is given, much more is required. All of us will stand before the judgment seat and give an account for the brain and the knowledge and the information we had and withheld it from those who were hungry, dying and sick and needed the only physician, who is a great Samaritan, who paid all, and told the innkeeper, when I come again, if ever there is anything left, I will take care of it. So we all are responsible for the blood of Jesus Christ. Believe it, brethren. It's not about religion. It would never be about religion and denomination. Feel a spirit. Yes. Such a God. Ask him. He's a Samaritan, oh. He's a good. Sing to the King this morning. Samaritan, my God. He's a good. Jesus is the good Samaritan. He's a good. He's a good Samaritan.
He's a good.
this is beautiful, this is beautiful. One more time, the Good Samaritan. Hey, 2 minutes past the 8 o'clock. Lord, the phone is open for you on the outside. Spirit, what's on your mind this morning? We bless God for you. We are here to share, break the word of God, and encourage sinners to the altar. Come in.
He's a good,
receive Jesus. Be washed. Be purged, be cleansed. In the name of Jesus.
Jesus,
a free gift that's given to all humanity. Yes.
He's a good,
he's a good
Samaritan.
Samaritan.
He's a good,
he's a good
Samaritan.
Samaritan.
He's a good. Jesus is the good Samaritan. There was a man who on a far journey,
phone is open, 347-663-8638. Open forum, it's no special topic this morning. Whatever is on your mind, and it's all about edifying each other and strengthening each other in the Jesus Christ, in the Word of God. Amen. It's about lifting up Jesus and let everything else fall, diminish, be destroyed, that men can come to know Jesus. That he did. Make it available for all men to come to the throne of grace. Oh, glory to his name. 347-663-8638. The phone is open this morning. Wherever you are. My God.
Leave our past and never do a thing. Priest came.
Hallelujah.
And do the same.
Tell me.
Oh, there came a good Samaritan.
He bounded my wound, the brethren.
He's a good Samaritan.
Bless God for Jesus.
He's a good Samaritan.
Oh.
He's a good.
Come on.
Oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh.
Jesus,
yeah.
He's a good
Samaritan.
Hallelujah.
He's a good
Indy good this morning.
He's a good,
he's a good
Samaritan.
Samaritan.
He's a good, Jesus is a good Samaritan. Jesus is,
Jesus
a good Samaritan.
My God.
Jesus is,
Jesus is.
Hallelujah. I'm gonna do it one more time. It's called Arise, right here on Choice Radio. Good morning.
Spirit.
If you have a comment, something you want to share this morning, something you have heard and you want clarity, something we have said,
Samaritan.
And you have a rebuttal, you want to challenge it, whatever it is, I don't know. I don't mean challenge in a way that, you know, yeah, we, you know. As I always say, I stand corrected. You bring your scriptures. Let's speak about the word of God. Amen. But just know you cannot support what's against Jesus. You will be wrong. Very wrong. To go against the cross of Christ. To join up with them. Whoever the them is. Hallelujah.
Who fell among some thieves? They took all that he had and beat the poor man so bad.
347
He's a good
663-8638. Brother Raymond. How are you, my brother?
So many times. He's a
Indeed, a beautiful morning, we must say. Amen. If you're out there this morning, brethren, something on your mind this morning, give us a call and share with us. We apologize yesterday, the phone definitely. I was on a way, it was not connecting. So all those who tried to get through and didn't get through, we apologize for that. Amen. Hopefully this morning is working. Hallelujah. Eight minutes past the 8 o'clock. It's Choice Radio, your life, your salvation, your choice. We are here to encourage each other in Jesus. It's all about walking with the Lord, brethren. Many are called and few are chosen, and few will be chosen for what we have chosen to do or to follow. We can be cute. We can be intelligent. We can be good looking. But we all got to make our calling and our election sure. Honesty before God. A pure heart. A clear conscience in the sight of the Son of Man. Yes. Be willing, brethren. Three, four, seven, six, six, three, eight, six, three, eight. I'm loving this rhythm right there. Think about the Good Samaritan when he took you from the miry clay, from the bottomless pit. My God. If you're getting there for nine, move it.
Leave I pass, and never do I flee. The priest came and do the same.
347.
Oh dear.
663-8638. Let's go to the phone caller. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. The Good Samaritan.
Bless the Lord this morning.
Yes. The word of the Most High is speaking scripture. He's speaking. The word is speaking. So we thank him most of all for his word today, which is Christ Jesus, the living word.
Hallelujah.
God bless the entire family and even the family that's to come. We bless the Lord. What's on my mind this morning? Here we go. In the churches today, we have something that they call unknown tongues, right? And tongues here and tongues there. And it's not scriptural. Because sometimes people have to learn that, and you notice the same words being uttered over and over. I've learned from the scripture, from the book of Acts, on the day of Pentecost, when they received the Holy Spirit, that when they were filled with the Holy Spirit, because they were on one accord, they began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance, right? And at the same time, them tongues now, these tongues now, they were speaking in, there were men dwelling from different places, Jews, you know, devoted men of every nation under the heaven. And each one heard them speak in their own tongue, which is their language. So if I'm going to hear a tongue speaking in another language I don't understand, it have to be identified with a language of today. It cannot be what we call gibberish. So that's what the most I put on my heart, to let the children of the Most High investigate and see what it is that we're getting into.
Bless the Lord. Well, let me say this to you, between me and you personally, my brother. God is a spirit, right?
Yes.
And
sir,
he that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Let me just give you my little history, being born again and coming to Christ. Even when before I received Jesus officially in that way, we had some Seventh-day Adventist people on the radio here at Choice Radio. We bless God for them. And, you know, they were speaking about this thing one night, and I could not receive it. I don't know why. And every day I learn about God, and I learn new things, and I'm open to learn from God, you know. And what I believe about God, you see, when God see that you open and you're willing to receive something, he gives it to you. If you have a resistance because of anything or you hold back, you know, then you would not receive it, because you are not totally submitted. Because the Bible says we must become like a little child. So if the little child is curious and say, "Oh my God, what is this? Is this real? My God, I don't know. Wow!" And your whole notion is as a child. When God see that you are really submitted as a child, God is able to illustrate it to you, because he see that you are genuine in terms of your approach or your look at that thing, then he will show you. Right now, I heard him on the radio talking about it one night, and talking about it and trying to give the same analogy was given from the book of Acts, which is a reality in the book of Acts, right? But what happened to me, I just did not receive it, that they're trying to say that everything about it has to be a language and stuff like that, whatever it is. Now, one night I was just blessing the Lord and praising God, and I was just praising God. But before that one, I was going to pick up my wife in Manhattan one time. So I was on a prayer line with the first church I used to go to, second church I used to go to, and we was on a prayer line, and it was my turn to pray, and I started to just pray, and I have the earpiece in my ears, and I was just praying, and I driving across the, as I hit the Manhattan Bridge, my brother, my voice just went into it just went into a place that I had no clue. I was not even trying. There was nothing about, I was just praying in my regular words, and my words just changed over. But I must tell you what it sounded like. It was not like some rapa tapa tapa. It was saying something that I didn't understand, but it was really something like somebody speaking probably Chinese or whatever it is. It sounded like a real, real, real language. So it didn't sound like some rikitiki, whatever, rakataka, whatever. It didn't sound like that. So I knew, and when I finished praying, I mean, the phone was quiet for a long while. It's like everybody probably say, "Wow, what was that?" Then guess what? Let me show you again. So one night I was home again praying, and I was just looking out in the window. You know, my wife was in bed, and I was just there out there blessing, thanking God and giving him praise, even for the apartment where I was living. I was thanking him because I always wanted to read my Bible and have a clarity and no noise in the background. And where I'm living now is just so quiet. If I drop a pin on the ground, you hear it. It's so quiet. I could just really sit there and whatever. So now I was just looking out the window, and I was just praising God and thanking him. Then I was telling him, like, "How did you do this? All the flowers you make, and how you, all this food and the trees and the season. How you, oh my God, how you do all this thing? Oh my God." And I was just giving the praise like this. And I just went into, I just went into something. And again, it was really like I was saying something that no man could have taught me to say. It was something very, very, very spiritual. It was something very real. So that has been my personal, you know, encounter with that what you're talking about. Now, unfortunately, what has happened is. And Paul was really talking to the people in Corinth and telling them, yes, these things that you're talking about are available, but not in the way that you are articulating it. It should not be done in that kind of way. I could teach you to do it and tell you to start to utter and tell you all this kind of stuff. It is the Spirit that leads. That is by scripture. This has been my confirmation. God is not an author of confusion. As a matter of fact, Paul was telling them, look, in the congregation, if you do not have an interpreter, do not speak. Paul tell them this is a commandment from God. No, hold on. Listen to me.
I'm not laughing at you. What you say is true so much that it gives me a humor to hear you say it.
Right. Now, hear this.
But go ahead.
Mm-hmm. Now, people might be listening to me and they get mad, because I remember some people who used to always text me, call me. Then they get mad when they hear me talk about this thing, because what? But that's up to them. That's up to them.
Yes.
Listen to me.
Yes.
God said, when light come, you walk in the light. You see, if you didn't know something from back in the days, and we have an adversary, which is the devil, and his deal is to try to confuse and create confusion and all this kind of stuff and wildness. We need proof to everything that we do. It must be substantiated with scripture. Whatever we do must be led by a true and a pure heart. Now, what I'm trying to say is, God does give you the utterance to speak. I'm telling you, my brother, this is something you have to be willing to do and submit to do, that God can speak. But I'm saying, to me, you cannot teach somebody to do it. You can tell them to yield to God, yield the tongue to God, and then whatever it is, God will speak to them. But guess what? Because we have an adversary, if he know that your desire is just to speak to make an impression, the devil can enter you and speak or whatever, because your intention is not pure. You are not really worshiping God with a pure heart. So we have to be mindful and we have to be careful of this. Now listen to me.
Hallelujah. Yes,
listen to me. Paul said, look, let me tell you something. I don't want you to be ignorant about these things. No, do not, in the body of Christ, in the church, if you do not have an interpreter, you do not speak. Paul was correcting them. He said, look, you know, do not do this kind of craziness. You understand me? If you have an interpreter and if you know what you're saying, and between two and three, they will judge what you're saying if it's coming from the Spirit of God. So if one person do it, next person answer. Somebody do it, somebody answer. Why? That the church of God could be edified and know that God is truly among us, speaking to his people. In the conclusion of that scripture, Paul said, look, hear what Paul said, the great apostle Paul that they're talking about, and they're quoting Paul. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 14 and 36, he said, what? Came the word of God out of from you? Now he's telling these people in Corinth, you trying to say that you know about God more than me? You know about God more than us who came with the gospel? He said, what? Came the word of God out from you, or came it unto you only? Did it come to you only? Is it only you that could read the scripture? He said, look, if any man think himself to be a prophet or spiritual, let him acknowledge that these things that I write unto you are the commandments of the Lord. He said, look, listen to me. I write unto you are the commandments of the Lord. But if any man be ignorant, let him be ignorant. Wherefore, brethren, covet to prophesy and forbid not to speak in tongues. So hear what he's saying. Covet. Be you know, really seek to prophesy. Because if you're prophesying, you're really prophesying the word of God to bring God, lift up the word of God, that men can, the Spirit of God can fall and people can experience the real tangible power of Jesus. So he said, look, but don't forbid to speak in tongues. That means don't forbid, because the point is, if you home, like I said before, and you're just speaking to God and you're just telling God, I just thank you for this job, I bless you, God, you are great, and you go, don't stop, don't think it's crazy, because you're genuinely praising your God, and whatever God will put in you, you go ahead with it, because your heart is pure to God. So God, but then again, as you keep doing it, God will teach you to even be better and clearer and whatever, and then probably you ask him for interpretations. So then now you can really be a blessing to the body of Christ. So if you come in and you actually speak with real tongues from God, when God give you an utterance, then you say, guess what? He said here, da 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 da, and somebody say, yes, sister, it's true, the Lord reign, praise God, and the whole congregation give praise. Then also the unbeliever, he will know in his spirit that this was truly the God of Israel. Then he go away saying, man, I want to join these people. They truly know God. So because God is not an author of confusion. So the key is, in the book of Acts we saw, yes, it was real tangible, different kinds of tongues to validate the power of Christ coming on the earth at that time to dispense the gospel, because Jesus said, look, do not leave Jerusalem until you are capable of speaking to different people, or you receive that power, that when you go to different places, that power will be installed in you, that if you need to speak, the Spirit of God will speak through you in this different language. But I say to you, as Paul was instructing the people, yes, God is the one that orchestrated the speaking. That is to my understanding from the scripture. And like I said, you have to look at what Paul is saying here. Listen to what Paul is saying. Paul is saying, look, what a big question mark. You have your Bible, 1 Corinthians 14. He say, what came the word of God out from you, or came it unto you only? This is some serious thing Paul is saying. Paul is rebuking these people and telling them, what are you trying to tell me? You trying to say you know about God more than us, who came from where Jesus Christ was born? You saying that what I'm trying to correct you in and tell you in, you trying to tell me about it? So really, my brother, this confusion that is going on, and you know, everybody, listen, the key about God, God is very long-suffering.
Hallelujah.
You can do a lot of stuff with God, and when you get there, he will tell you iniquity was found in you. You know what iniquity means? Iniquity is all kind of gimmicks and witchcraft and all kind of foolishness that you added on to the word of God, or you applied knowing that it was not scriptural, but yet for all you did it for your own personal reason. And you know, a lot of people are not going to like what I'm going to say, but this is the Bible we're talking about. We're talking about the word of God. So I have no way to retreat. I'm not going to retreat from Jesus. I'm not going to retreat from the word of God. I will tell people, it's up to you if you want to take the counselor. You don't want to take it. But whenever we speak, we're talking about the scripture. Now, Paul said, look, if any man speak in an unknown tongue, let it be by two or most by three. And that by course, let one interpret. You see? Because God is not an author of confusion. You talk rabba-dabba-dabba-dabba, you better tell me what rabba-dabba-dabba mean. You better tell me what it's saying. You better tell me what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. And I say to people, look, don't go ahead and follow anybody against the word of God. You will be wrong. You will be wrong. That's all I'm going to tell you. You can choose your own road. Go with your people. Say, oh, that's what I know. That's what my grandfather do. Well, your grandfather did what he did when he didn't know the scripture. You have light. If you have light, you have to seek God to walk in light. But my brother, I will say to you, open to the Spirit of God, because you, my brother, might get utterance from God just to validate that yes, that is a spirit that will make you speak in tongues, but nobody cannot teach you to do it. They can try to tell you, well, what kind of way to lean yourself in terms of, you know, submit your heart to God, make sure you are pure in your heart and your intention is right and whatever. Because many times people want to do something just because they want to impress people. You know, they want to be seen, they want to be heard, they want to be known. Oh my God, she could really speak in her tongues, you know. My God, you see? So no, but we're human beings.
To get the glorification of man, instead of validating God's word in our hearts, in our mind, the way we live our lives, we need men glorification. That is very true. And at the same time with the scripture, he said, but if there be no interpreter, in other words, if I hear one person in church speaking in tongue, and somebody else can, or that person can tell me what they say, he said, let him keep silent in the church and let him speak to himself and to God. So you know, it's a beautiful thing to explore, and let's speak the Most High words. Whether we innocent or guilty, the word stands, so we have to speak it.
And hallelujah.
This is how the Most High will elevate us, because we love him so much that we are willing to sacrifice our lives for the word. Because the true word already sacrificed his life for us, which is the living word, Christ himself, Yahshua the Messiah. He already done it. So the salt have to be salty, and that light have to keep on shining as bright as ever. Because you remember back home, or even here, or any place you go, you just pick up a rock, or just put on the light, and so all of a sudden, whatever is underneath, it scatter. So is the word of God, that light permeating the entire earth, because he gave us the authority. He already given it to us. We just have to seize it and let him do the work in us. On this note, my brother, I just want to thank the Most High for you, the ministry, all the listeners, those who come, those who are coming, and may the Most High continue to inspire us daily to seek him and do his work, because it's a dying world, and those who love him will survive. Those who don't, well, you know, every man have his own destiny and choice, but we are encouraging everyone listening to give their heart and soul to Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you, my brother. Bless God indeed.
God bless you, sir.
God bless you too, my brother, in Jesus' name. 28 minutes past the 8 o'clock. As the young man was speaking, I want to encourage you out there. I want to let you understand that God is no respecter of persons. First of all, remember, I always tell people this. Anything to do with God, if you are not sure about it, you say, Father, you know, I really want to know about this. And when God see that your heart is totally yielded, you're thinking like a baby, like a little child. You're not criticizing, but you just say, you know, that just don't feel right to me, Father. I want you to show me exactly what it means. When you are humbled and you are ready, God can show you that this is how this thing works, and this is the way the thing is. Amen. And even when after I know I had these two experiences like this, so clear like this, probably I might be someplace praying or whatever. And because I had the experience before, I could be even tempted to do the same thing or try to recap what I did before. But my spirit is not going to allow me to do it, because it's going to be fabricated. You see what I'm saying? The Bible said that the spirit is the one that gives the utterance. You understand me? So, and again, we have to remember, God does not want confusion. If a stranger come in among you, or somebody who are not yet spiritually built up, and they come to the worship, and we start going on like this and going on with all this stuff, and he walk away saying, what kind of stuff is this, man? These people just going on with stuff. Because why? He in his spirit have not received it and cannot receive it. Because why? It's not true. If it's genuine, he will know that there is something about it. He might not understand what it is, but if it's genuine, God will confirm to his heart that yes, I was speaking. You didn't understand what was going on, but I was indeed speaking. But according to what Paul counseled the church, let there be an interpreter, that people will not walk away and thinking that this is a joke. And this is what we see happening all day around, all over the place, like if it's normal. And people sit there and they read the scripture and they say, well, I don't care what the scriptures say, I'm going to go along with it. Well, you will be wrong. You will be wrong. You see, the only day you're going to find out what you did is when you get before God. And God say, let me ask you something. Didn't I send you to college? Didn't I allow you to achieve how many degrees? Were you the person who did this and this and this? Then how did you do this? What are you trying to tell me? What are you saying? What I give you wasn't enough? I mean, I'm just talking like this because God is not the author of confusion, and God knows everything. And I have people get very mad with me because they say, oh, what you trying to say? Da, 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 da. And they feel they're defending something. You see, the only thing we could defend is the word of God, or defend our stands according to the word of God. Let every man be a liar, period. You know, period. I let every man be a liar, and let God be true. This is what I say, and this is what I believe, and this is God know my heart, God know me. So you might listen to me and say, oh, what do you think is holy? No, I'm not thinking I'm holy, but I know Jesus Christ have saved my life. You see what I'm saying? And based on what he has put in me, I am here willing to yield myself to the Spirit of God, that I can be of service to strengthen somebody, to encourage somebody with what God has put in me. Son, I'm not saying I'm better than you, I'm better than he, I know this, I know that. But all I'm trying to tell you, brethren, you and I have an obligation to God to let his word be his word. Amen. So this letter to the Corinthians was a lot of rebuking there of different things that these people were doing. You know what I mean? And Paul was rebuking these people. Is that not Paul is not telling people? Paul is rebuking these people. Let them look at this in the same scripture we were reading before in 1 Corinthians, like I said, 14. You have your Bible. Paul say, what? I mean, what came the word of God out from you? It's like you say, reggae music came from Jamaica, and the Jamaicans have a thing, they have the market on it. And let's say soca music came from Trinidad, and they have the market on it. They really, you know, so they have the market. So Paul is trying to tell them, what you trying to say, Corinthians? You trying to tell me that this word of God came to you first? Do you have a handle on this word? Paul is telling them, no, we have a handle on this word. And we are telling you what it's really all about. And I'm here to instruct you what it's all about. You understand? You don't go along and do all this stuff like that. You do it according to scripture. You do it according to what is given to you. You do it that way. But to each his own. To each his own. Because many people are not going to listen. They're not going to listen. They will quote and say, Paul say this. But they will not listen to his instruction. And before he finished, he said, in 38, he said, well, let me just read the whole thing again for you who didn't hear. 1 Corinthians 14 and 37. If any man think himself to be a prophet or spiritual, let him acknowledge that the things that I write unto you are the commandments of the Lord. But if any man be ignorant, let him be ignorant. Wherefore, brethren, covet to prophesy. And in the explanation before, he said prophesying is great. Everybody could understand prophesying. You know what I mean? And forbid not to speak in tongues. So he say, don't forbid it. That means don't hold it back. If God is trying to speak to you to illustrate his power, don't hold it back. If you have the gift and your heart is pure and you're in the congregation and the words is just coming out of you and you couldn't hold it back, you didn't try to do it, but it's coming out of you pure and coming out of you and God is speaking from you, don't hold it back. Let it come out and ask him. Let us interpret. Because again, in the congregation, while one person speak, God will put it in the heart of another person, maybe the minister, to say, oh, praise Jesus. And he go to a scripture and quote and he say, that's what he was saying, my God. You see, so that is how God wants to operate, that his spirit can be seen as real, relevant, tangible, that men can believe God even more. Amen. And I myself have some experience with people I meet on a daily basis who the biggest problem is with the church. In the way they portray God, the way they present God, the way they handle the word of God, the way they do different functions in the church, and it is stopping people from coming to Jesus. And that is why we were speaking about this thing, and I was talking about the tithes and stuff. I'm not talking about the tithes to against it, but I'm talking about the application that is used and the scriptures utilized. Amen. Everything to God is an offering. So even if you decide to give a tithe as an offering to God, this is between you and God. It is still an offering to God that you are making in a form of a tithe. Could be a 10, could be a 20, whatever. But that's between you and your God. So no man cannot tell you that you are cursed with a curse and you're robbing God. And you cannot use that scripture to when you collecting any offering to God. Because as we read in Malachi, the Son of Jesus Christ came that we can present an offering in righteousness. So it's all an offering. Amen. Even when we saw with Jacob and everybody else, they decided to do that to God. It was their desire. They say, God, if you be with me, I'm going to give you a tenth. So it was still an offering that they made to God. You understand? So that's what I'm saying. So a man don't have to feel guilty when he come to the presence of God and you making him feel guilty and telling him he robbing God, because he's not robbing God. And you're doing an injustice to Jesus, because Jesus said he paid it all. This is what we're trying to get people to understand according to the scripture. You cannot go and diminish the finished works on Calvary with Jesus to tell people that they are cursed, because they are not cursed. We have been redeemed from the curse of the law, physical death, poverty, and sickness. And you see, the same scripture, they use it and they go around and use the next scripture behind it. What we saying? What we saying? So I'm just trying to say, brethren, if we all are willing to humble to God, you understand me, and let God be God, we all can be better people for it. You understand? So many people don't understand what they might hear me talking and think I'm talking against this. If you want to give God a tithe, it should not be mandated or mandatory or brought to you to make you feel guilty you didn't pay your tithes and we are the big tithers and all this foolishness in the house of God. This is not Jesus. This is not of God. This is men in the flesh. Covetous men, greedy men. Wolves in sheep clothing. That's what it is. Hallelujah. Because we are brought to freedom. We are brought to liberty in Christ. When we come to worship God, let God have his way with us. Just preach Jesus. Talk about God. Talk about his goodness. Preach the word of God and say, God, by your power today, we're going to collect the offering for Jesus as we come before his throne. Because remember, he is our high priest. So when we came to God the first time, he redeemed us. He received us. He washed us. So every time we come to worship him, we bring something to him, to our Lord. We say, Father, that's what I bring today. Father, that's what I'm bringing you today. God, here is this in my day. You see? So you come to worship the King with your offering. You come to worship with your tithe if you bring your tithe. But it should never be mandatory. It should never be stipulated as if it's owed to God, because you're robbing God. You understand me? And this is what we're trying to get over. That's why we come back from time to time. We do one topic one day, another day, to try to really instate and really engrave the notion or the idea or the what we're trying to bring forward. We're saying you cannot tell people that they curse, because they are not cursed. You understand me? And you're going to have a problem with God. That's what the Bible, the scripture said, they deny the Lord that bought them. We need to read the scripture in context. He said they deny the Lord that bought them. It means Jesus is saying, I paid it all for you and all sinners, but you're telling the people, no. That's kind of, you know, we told you that outside to get you in the church, but now you come, you really didn't pay all, you know, you got to pay rest because Jesus owed this and Jesus owed that, and you're still robbing God, so you got to do that. But Jesus paid all the rest of it, but someone he couldn't pay, you have to pay, so you're responsible. I mean, that's basically what you're saying to the people. You understand me? And we want people to understand that you're a leader all day. Look, the blood is going to be on your hand. If a man walk away from the church because he feels so burdened and guilty because he have nothing to give, and you make him feel that he owe God and he rob God, and there is no joy in his worship because he just feel bad that he owe God, that's not good. And that is from the angle at which we speak when we talk about that. So many of you, you're mad, you're upset. Oh, he's talking about tithe. Oh, I love my tithing. Yes, nothing wrong with if you love your tithing. Nothing wrong with that. The key is the man who have not yet been circumcised in the heart and don't know Jesus. When he hear you and your friends with all your religious things that you get along with, because you're religious, so you go along with it, and you make it a burden to him, you stopping him from coming to God. You could say, well, he's cheap and he don't want to give no money. No, if he carnal, he cannot understand. What we need to do is teach him about Jesus, invoke the Spirit of God, that God will speak to his heart and make him bring an offering worthy to God. And this is the way God has designed the church, that is all by the heart. You understand me? So what God wants is us to cultivate a heart for Jesus, that we love him so much that when we come to the church, we bring an offering, one offering, period. You could do whatever you want with it, but one offering from that person, you bring it. That's what the Bible is saying. And that's why we see God is very, listen, God know the heart of men, you know, and he know why he do certain things. He made sure from Acts, he never mentioned it once. No apostle mentioned it once. He want to see what you're going to do with it. He want to see what you're going to do with it. Because many of us, we like to say Jesus Christ nailed everything to the cross, but he could not nail the money to the cross. You see that? That's why the Bible said the love of money is the root of all evil. So they will try to find a way to go back and take it. Take it up back. They will want to say, he fulfilled this, he fulfilled Sabbath, he fulfilled this, he fulfilled all this. But the money part, he didn't have enough money in his pocket to fulfill that part on the cross. I know you're hearing me. I know you're listening to me, brethren. It's the word of God. It's the word of God. And many people will have to go to God and say they're sorry for doing what I'm talking about. You see, we can use all the application, but it should never be used as a rebuke to the people of God or to the men and women who come into Jesus. It should never be a burden on the believer when he stumbled into the house of God to thank him for another day, and you're going to tell him, well, okay, all who are not paying their tithes in here, well, they better don't come back. You know, you have one pastor tell people don't come back? Yes, a pastor tell people don't come back. If you don't have your tithes, don't come. You're wasting your time. Could you imagine this? So some people who are just legalistic and just religious, they, oh, they're mad, we're talking about tithes. But when we're talking about the Bible, the word of God, you have to care about your brothers and sisters who are not spiritual as you, because you is the Miss Spiritual, you is Miss Holy Holy, and you know your Bible so good. So yeah, you want to go along with everything, and anybody who talk different, you're mad with them because they're going against your church and your group and your people and your pastor. That's what we do here, everybody happy with that. Well, yes. But the man from the outside, you have to care about him. That's why the Bible says, any one of these little ones who love me, that you cause not to get to me, your blood is going to be on their hand. You think God is joking? He said, any one of these little ones who don't know me, that you cause. And in another scripture, he said, because you are not going into the kingdom, you causing other people not to be able to enter. You going to have to pay for it. Amen. So that's what I'm trying to say when we talk about these things. We're not trying to tell you this or this or this. in the New Testament, it's all about an offering. It's all about the heart. It's all about your heart, as your purpose in your heart to give to your God. Is my God. I deal with my God my way. You cannot tell me how to deal with my God. And this is what the scripture is portraying, that Jesus Christ had paid it all for humanity. And when they come into the presence of the Lord, the Bible says there is fullness of joy in the presence of the Lord. Any man come to the presence of the Lord, there should be fullness of joy. You come and lay before the altar. Father, here I am, a sinner. Oh, glory to your mighty name. I give you praise. And when you get up, even if you don't have a dollar, he could walk out with the joy, knowing that he went before the altar, before his God. You cannot tell him how to come before his God. You're not his father. You don't own his money. You didn't work for him. The Bible tells you it's not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord. And I will tell you from my personal testimony dealing with the things of the Lord. You know, we just preach Jesus and God always supply. God always makes sure that we can do, keep doing what we're doing. Why? Because he's God. He's God. The Bible says, would God find faith? Well, the Son of Man find faith on the earth. Yes, he's going to find religion. Yes, he's going to find denomination. Yes, he's going to find all kind of prophet. Yes, he's going to find all kind of men talking all kind of stuff. But would he find faith on the earth? And the Bible tells you, without faith, it is impossible to please God. We must see the scriptures for what it is, brethren. Hallelujah. Amen. We bless God. Amen. The phone is open, brethren. If you're out there in radio land, we thank God for you today. And the key we have to care about in these last days is the remnant that is out there who have refused Jesus because of our religiosity, because of scribes and Pharisees in the modern day terminology that is keeping away the saints who want to come and give their heart to Jesus. They know the world is burdening them down. They know there is nothing else out there, but we have erected walls before them and Jesus. That is the argument. That is the conversation. This is the dilemma. And you and I will have to make our calling and our election sure, because the Bible said, to whom much is given, much more is required. Hallelujah. Glory to the name of the Lord Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. He's a good Samaritan this morning, brethren. Give us a call here on the Choice Radio.
Oh Lord, feel a spirit. He's a good Samaritan. He's a good Samaritan.
347-663-8638. And yes, this is a commandment from Jesus, as I was saying before. And we got to make sure we know that it is a commandment from the Lord.
The poor man so bad. He's a good Samaritan.
The phone is open. Am I speaking too fast? 347-663-8638. Brethren, if you're out there this morning, give us a call. Give us your concern, you know, something we said, you know, you have not received it and you wanna give us a call. Amen. Bless God.
Jesus
347-663-8638. Let's go back to the phones. Caller, good morning to you. God bless you.
Good morning, Minister Stryker.
Bless the Lord, my brother.
Oh, I just was calling you and telling you, like, you is the only man I ever hear since I knew going in church will speak this kind of scripture, because I go to church a few years ago and I never hear people come with this scripture. I don't know if they're hiding the truth from the people, but you is the only one, and you have people that don't even sit there and listen to the word scripture, because that is the scripture. Most of the things I listen that you say, it has been written. But I don't know if people will be blind towards it, because I have a church. I remember that some people used to be paying tithes, and that the woman, the minister, are collecting the money, making sure she watch who pay who, and so she could bring a report to the pastor, so the pastor could come and confront you and tell you, well, look, you're paying tithes, you know, brother, and you this and you that. So I think what you're saying is right. Yeah, because they will keep a report. And also, again, you won't be elevated just the same, because if you're not paying, you're not like an asset to them. So you will not be elevated in that church, because the one that collects the money make sure they keep a record of how much you're paying, so they could get it back to the pastor. And I don't think that is of God, you know. As you were saying, God, that's what God wants our heart. You want them kind of thing they're talking about.
Hallelujah.
You must keep on your good work and continue keeping on that work, and God will always use you because of what he's preaching, because he's preaching his word. You don't add in, you don't take it out, and that is good, and continue your good work.
Thank you, my brother. God bless you. Keep praying for us. All right.
Okay, you have a great day.
You too, my brother. Indeed, amen. Bless God. 10 more minutes before the hour of 9 o'clock indeed. And my brother, when you call back in the future, turn off your radio, okay, so we could have a nice, clear, you know, conversation. So, as the young man was saying before, now, I understand, like, some people, like, in a place like America and different places where rent is high and different things, and people, you know, worry how they're going to pay their rent. But the point is, if you are called by God to open a church, God, your Father, will take care of you. Yes, you can have one person in the church and God will supply all the money that the bills are paid. That's the God that we're talking about. And this is what God wants us to build our heart to believe in him. You understand me? So I'm saying to you, the thing about it, always talk about the scripture. Everything from Genesis all the way to the Revelation is the word of God. Everything is in there for our admonition, right? Like I said before, with Abraham gave not from his own money, but he gave from the spoils of the war. He gave the man a tenth of it, Melchizedek. Then we saw the young man, he tell God, if you will be with me, I think it's Isaac, if you be with me, I will give you a tenth. So he made an offer to God. He offered to make a deal with God. And it's the same way now, in same Malachi, the Bible tells you that Jesus is going to accept an offering in righteousness. You have your Bible? Malachi 3 and here it is. Malachi 3 and 3. And he shall sit as a refiner and purifier of silver. And he shall purify the sons of Levi, that's those before, purge them as gold and silver, that they may offer unto the Lord an offering in righteousness. Then shall the offering of Judah and Jerusalem be pleasing unto the Lord as in the days of old and as in former years. So it's going to be again according to the heart of the people, because even Isaac and all these people, they did it with their heart. They made a deal with God. So it was them and their God. You see? So let me ask you something. If a person decides to come in and say, you know what, I'm giving 100% today, you're going to say, no, sister, don't give 100%. It's only 10. No, you're going to take it. You're going to take it. You're going to say, bring all you have. Go bring your TV too. You see, we can't play with God. And this is what we try to understand. You can't play with God, and you cannot manipulate the things of God for your own gain. You're going to lose. You know, God gave us some guidelines, and that's why the Bible says he gave us a better covenant and better promises. Now, back in the days, that was a law that if you violated, you were deliberately against God. Now, it's all about the heart. So even if your heart is not cultivated right, God's not going to blame you, because you know your heart is not really there yet to really hear him. But you're not under any obligation as a law. And we should appreciate what God has done for us, because we are no longer under the yoke. We are no longer under a yoke. We are no longer stipulated. No, we can walk in the courts of God. We have liberty with Jesus. We can come in and say, Jesus, I'm here. I bring you a mango. I'm just saying. The point I'm trying to make is the way God has brought it. He said Jesus will receive an offering in righteousness. Hallelujah. Whatever your righteousness is with God is going to be your offering to God. So if you want to say, I'm making an obligation to give God a tenth of my money, you can do it. But no man cannot tell you and should not tell you that what you're doing is because you're paying God, because you rob God, and you don't want to be under a curse. This is what I'm trying to say, because this goes contrary to the scripture that said that Jesus Christ have redeemed us from the curse of the law, physical death, poverty, and sickness. This is what I'm trying to tell you. Because before he told them, if you do this, I'm going to rebuke the devourer for your sake. Because they were already under a curse, these people. You understand me? Physical Israel was under a curse already. So he said, he told them, this is what it is. If you keep doing what I tell you to do, I will rebuke the devourer for your sake. He was telling them that before. But now he said, I'm sending Jesus now. I don't need your money no more. I don't need that from you anymore. I'm sending Jesus. And when Jesus comes, he will cause you to offer an offering in righteousness. So when you come to God, he knows your heart. You know how much money you have. You know the truth about your life. He know what you could give. But he don't want nobody to dictate to you and beat you over your head and tell you, oh, well, nobody paid tithes in this place. Oh, that's why you're cursed. No, brethren. You're going to be wrong. You're going to before God, you are going to be wrong. I'm telling you right now. You don't have to believe me, but before God, you will be wrong. Because many places in the Bible, God give us illustration. And I was saying this. Jesus gave an illustration. He said, if a man come into your congregation in a goodly apparel, with suit and tie, well-dressed, looking nice and sharp, big ring on his finger, whatever it is, and you tell him, oh, brother, move over from that seat. Every day you come, you don't pay no tithes. Go to the back. Usher, put him someplace else to sit down. And you tell him, come, brother. Oh, have this beautiful seat near the pastor. Come sit near the bishop. What do you think? You think God don't know your heart? You might say, oh, well, I'm not thinking that. Yes, your heart is desperately wicked. In your heart, you already thinking, I wish we could make this man a deacon in here. Because the way he dressed, he must have some money. That is human being. And God know us. He know us. Hallelujah. Yeah. Yes. So that man, you will treat him differently because you believe he could give money. And guess what? Go and see. He's the one that giving the least. He's El Chipo. And the little old lady in the back is the one that bringing all the money to keep the church going. But you don't know that. You don't know that. You don't know that who's giving more. That's why God do not want us to walk by sight. And that's why we see many people who get elevated in churches. They're not elevated because they're spiritual. They're working in some places. They have a big job. And all of a sudden, you find they're so spiritual, you put them in a certain position. That's not God. And God is testing the people to see where our heart is. I'm telling you, you can't fool God. Let's go. Caller, good morning.
Good morning.
Bless the Lord.
Yes. I just want to say a little something. I just want to say, it is the same thing that the world is doing. I mean, this part of the scripture was for the people of that time, that it was because of whatever reason, but the world has kept it because that is a way of controlling, and that is a way of, like, you know, keeping people in bondage. Because right now you work, although you're going to work for your own money, it is your money you work for, but the government is the one that has a say in how much to get out of your money, and the more money you make, the more you take out of it. So it's like the church today, they are behaving just like the world, because the world kept all the things that the Bible told us not to do anymore. The world kept it, and the church is doing the same thing. So we ask ourselves, what is going on with churches today, because if they're keeping the same thing that God has told us when Jesus Christ came, that is no longer needed, that we are redeemed, and the churches are keeping it, they're just like the world. And we have to really open our eyes to those matters, because it is important for our walk in Christ. For when Christ come in, he said he's coming for a bride without spot and without wrinkle, and we all want to be that bride without spot and wrinkle, because the word of God says that he wished that none perish. And I'm sure that if we search ourselves, if we are at fault in doing anything that is contrary to the word of God, we need to search ourselves, read the Bible, go with the eyes of the understanding of the Spirit, and turn away from it, because it's going to hinder us from entering into the kingdom of God. We have to be blameless, each and every one of us. So today I just pray for myself, including and everybody else out there that is doing anything contrary to the word of God, that we seek his face, that we are going to be redeemed. Like he said, we are already redeemed from the curse of the law. So whatever that the devil is going to throw at us, it's not going to get us, because God has paid the price for us, and we have to walk in that newness. As the word of God says, when the light comes, we need to walk in the light. You know, because if the light comes and you don't walk in it, then you're going to be at fault. So I admonish each and everyone today, no matter what the situation is, what you're going through, seek God's face with that understanding. Do not be like the man in Psalms, in Proverbs 7, that he was void of understanding, and this woman took him down to the chambers of hell by first
seducing him,
a dagger to his liver, and killing him. And we know that death is the death, that he did not go to heaven. He's not going to heaven. He's not a bride of Christ. So I just want to just share this today, because it's important for all of us. I know that there are persons out there who have destined, who have made their mind to do what they have to do. But with God, everything is possible. Nothing is impossible with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And if we seek him, we will find him. Okay, so that's my contribution for today.
Definitely. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
All right. He is a good Samaritan. Exactly 9 o'clock. Indeed, we bless God for you out there in Radio Land. And brethren, we say to you, it's all about Jesus. The Bible said, to whom much is given, much more is required. He said, many are called and few are chosen. And basically, few will be chosen based on what we have chosen to do, who we have chosen to follow, who we allow to be our God. Hallelujah. It would never be about who is popular and who is name brand and who is known and who is. It would never be about that. It's about those who have chosen to follow the Most High according to his word. And many people are operating under a curse for going back and take up their customs of the old time. Because if you go back and do the law, the Bible tells you, any man who go back in the law or anything that was given in the law, he's a debtor to do the whole law. That means if you go back and take up the things that God take away from these Israelites, you are going to be under the curse. So you might even think that what you're doing is you walking under the blessing. No, you're still walking under the curse, because you're still going back under a stipulation that was not given to you. It was not given to you. It was given to them at the time. So I'm just saying this, because many of you might be out there and you say, well, I've been doing all this, but I open all my windows, but I still don't see nothing. For 20 years I've been doing this, and up to now I don't see not even nothing to say I really and truly is blessed by God. Why? Because you're operating under a curse. You're not operating the liberty of Jesus, and you have submitted your will under man's will. Hallelujah. Amen. Glory to Jesus. So redeem, the meaning of redeem, what is said here? Redeemed, past is a past tense. Amen. Hallelujah. It's vindicate. You are vindicated. Gain or regain possession of something in exchange for payment. Hallelujah. Amen. Bless God. Let's go back to the phone in the name of Jesus. Caller, good morning to you. Grace and peace unto you.
Yes, good morning, Minister Shrika.
Bless God. Good morning to you, my brother.
Yes, sir. I'm just driving to work right now, listening to you talking about, the tithes and offering and what God requires of us. And I believe we should, follow exactly teachings of Jesus Christ. Like in the Bible, when in the New Testament, Matthew, when the disciples came to him and they wanted, because when he talked about the temple, he said that, see that all these things you know, must stand up as I shall, be, shall not be left here. One stood upon another that shall not be thrown, that shall not be, you know, broken down or thrown down. And the Sabbath came to him, and, you know, when shall these things be? What shall be the signs of their coming and of the end of the world? And he went on to say that, you know, take heed that no man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying that I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And I think people have a misunderstanding about this word, because they think actually like it's going to be a man who actually come and say that I'm Jesus Christ, I'm coming to take you from heaven. But no, the word actually says to take heed that no man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying that I am Christ. And I believe that he's talking to all these buildings, all these churches and them out here. Because at the end of the minister street, we can set up a 10 and start church. We don't have to really need, you know, the congregation to dip deep in their pockets to what? The Father said, render your heart and not your garment. So at the end of the day, that what I realize about these churches nowadays, these churches, I'm talking about every single church, these churches are registered with the government. They have a plan with respect that they don't pay any tax. They're registered with the government of this land, and therefore, like God said, render to Caesar the things of Caesar, which is the coin that they bring the coin to him. And Jesus told him, render to Caesar the things of Caesar, but the things of God, render to God. So at the end of the day, God has a business. Look at the woman who went in and anointed Jesus' feet with that pure oil. The people in them watching the lady, judging she like she was crazy, like, why is she using this expensive oil to wash the master's feet? And then he look at him and say, surely that this woman has given more than what anybody else has given. So, like I said, Minister Straker, the work is by your heart and not your garment. And these men nowadays who run these establishments, these buildings, these businesses, I call it, you understand that they are misleading people. Like, you know, like, salvation is free, and God really doesn't want anybody to be lost. But if you go ahead and telling people that, hey, if you don't come to church, you have to give something, you have to give, you understand? Like, what does that have to do with my eternity? What does that have to do? What about the, if everybody who was coming to church wasn't working, then we wouldn't have a building? So we might as well put up a tent and don't charge anybody for anything. Because what are we charging? We're charging to hear the word of God, which is free. Salvation is free. So then, at the end of the day, this is the last time that Jesus was talking about. He was saying to take heed about these people, these men who come in my name, not necessarily a prophet who will come and say, I am Jesus Christ. No. It's these men who stand behind the pulpit and they say that, I am Jesus Christ. I am talking about Jesus Christ. And whatsoever I do is for Jesus Christ. It's a total misconception, a total leading away from the truth, Mr. Straker. And you couldn't touch the topic even much more, you know. It's some really serious times that we're living, but people just want to be like, oh yeah, you know, we go to church, give my little 10, give my little 20. You know, it's all for the Lord's word, but the Lord's word is in vain. You don't see these people standing up on Capitol Hill against the government. You don't see these people marching together. You don't see these churches coming together and marching against the stuff that's going on in the community or standing up. All they want to do is sit down in the building and be shielded by these concrete walls. But like you said, that these stones would not be left here one upon another. You're going to build that work in the hearts of men. So let these people and them go ahead and think that sitting down in this church, that they're guaranteeing the salvation. Because at the end of the day, people need salvation out there. Y'all sitting on these benches and warming them. You got people dying every single day. People who don't even know the goodness of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, just like the thief on the left. You understand? And the thief on the right. One of the thieves said, since you are God, come down and save us. And the next one looked at him and said, Father, forgive me. I waited. He said, from this day forth, you will be with me in paradise. I didn't see one time at this one. It didn't even say that this man went to church and gave tithes and offerings. It didn't say that this man actually did good or anything about his life. It just said that he was just a thief. That was it. And he asked his father for forgiveness, and his father forgave him. So at the end of the day, these men and these false prophets out here who are trying to profess a certain way with respect to, like, if you don't walk this certain way, you cannot guarantee they cannot be guaranteed eternal life. It's all a lie and a sham, and they're using the word. And like you said, they have their reward. You understand? They're using the word, and the devil is fully planted in these churches, blind these people and them to the fact that they don't even know what the love of Jesus Christ is anymore. The love of Jesus Christ is look at a thief who didn't do nothing for God throughout his whole life. And upon a dying bed, he cried unto the Lord, and the Lord saved him. And now he is in paradise with the Father. Shows a lot compared to what these people are preaching for hours and sermons and hours, just misleading people. They're so blind, and I hope that they hear the word that Minister Straight are saying this morning. Thank you.
Well, it's the word of the Lord. Thank you for the call and the comment. And something you said, very important, and I like how the Lord put that revelation to you. Many shall come in my name saying, agreeing that I am Christ. They agree that Jesus is truly Lord. Then deceive many. So they will acknowledge, yeah, they say, yeah, Jesus is Lord for true. But then they will deceive many. So, amen. Take heed of fools. Hallelujah.
Thank you,
my brother. All right, my brother. Have a good day. Amen. Bless God. All right. He's a good Samaritan. The phone is open, and we just want to bring clarity with whatever we're speaking about on Church Radio. We say it's all about the Bible. It's all about the Word of God. And we're not trying to go against this and against that. Jesus' Church is the people who love Jesus and love the Lord with all their heart, mind, and soul. Appreciate salvation, being born again, and they want to serve God and see souls saved. Call us, turn off your radio. Good morning. Turn off your radio, please, caller. Turn off the radio, please. Turn off the radio, please, ma'am.
All right, thank you.
Turn off the radio, please.
Yes, good morning.
Good morning.
Thank God for your goodness. Thank God for His goodness towards you. And whatever you have been saying, it is the truth. The pastor doesn't have to tell you. The Holy Spirit will tell you what to give. Whatever money, a minister told me, he said whenever he goes out on the road and people give him, let's say, $5, he said, sister, I usually take out 1/10 from him. So when he takes out, I laughed. He said, wait, brother, you taking out 1/10 from that? But I learned that through the years after that, talking, I learned through the years that whatever money come in my hand, he didn't tell me to do it, as his spirit did lead. Every money comes in my hand, I take out 1/10 for the Lord. And if my 1/10 is $43, I put a $7 with it and run it off, and that is $50, and I put it there for the Lord. When I put it and I give it to the church will know what to do with it. I don't have to stipulate. So according to the Spirit, run it off is the Spirit. The Spirit that gives the utterance, and then we follow the leading of the Spirit. They that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. To thine own self be true. Shakespeare said it, to thine own self be true, but it is the fact, to thine own self be true, so that we would be able to uplift God's children, as how you are on the airway talking to people, giving people advice. You tell them, look in the Bible, so, you said, you usually say, brethren, not what I say. Look in the scripture for backup. So when they come in on the air, they gotta come with the backup, with the word of God. Not come patter, 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 patter. The word of God says so. And so it is, I am saying this morning, Father bless and keep you and your Choice Radio forever. So be
hallelujah.
In Jesus' name.
We declare it and decree it in Jesus' name. Amen. 12 minutes past the 9. And like I said, in terms of bringing clarity to what we're talking about, we're saying that Jesus Christ has brought us to liberty. Liberty means that we have a free course in the throne of God. We can come in. Any believer, when they wake up in the morning, they decide to go to the house of the Lord, where they can walk in and just praise their God and hear the word of the God and walk away and say, Jesus, I thank you. Whatever God has put on their heart, then they will give and they will commit it to the Lord. And this is the plan of God, that men have no excuse for not to come to the Lord. And right now, this is the excuse that people is getting against the church. They say, well, I used to go, but I can't go. I can't take it. My heart cannot take it. A young lady said, she was telling me she feels so bad. Her mother is not working, and in the church, the way they're treating her mother now, she says she feels so sick. She said, my mother did so much in that church, and now she's not working. And she go to the church, and the way that they look at her, the way that they talk and they reproach, and the pastor reproach, how could this be Jesus? How could this in the world be Jesus, brethren? Hallelujah. If you have received Jesus, if you see, like I always say, the Bible said the beginning of wisdom is the fear of God. And if any man fear for the little ones who want to come to Jesus, that they are being a blockage for that person. See, they're holding the gate for Jesus. If you don't pay your money, you can't come inside. Hallelujah. You will have to deal with God about that. You will have to deal with God. Like I said before, all these different things, a man can agree, I will give a God a tenth of my money. That is you and your God. That is you and your God. You can make that deal with God. And every day I come and try to clarify what I'm saying. If you agree that I want to make a deal with my God, I want to give a God a tenth, 20%, 5% of my money, you go to Father, what I'm going to do? In this money I'm getting, I'm going to give you that. And you and your God make your deal. When you're ready, you change for God. I'm changing the deal I'm making with you. Based on this, I'm going to give you that. I'm going to give you that. That is between you and your Father in heaven. Hallelujah. No man cannot tell you that you are robbing God and you're cost and you're this and you're that. Because this is going against the scripture. Jesus Christ have redeemed mankind from the curse of the law, physical death, poverty and sickness. So you giving to God and stuff like that, this will depend on your reward in heaven. It's not a criteria for salvation. You see what I'm saying? Giving to any ministry or any church is not a criteria to be saved. If you are saved, then by the Spirit of God, you will be drawn to give to God. But it's not a criteria for salvation. So to tell a man, if you don't do that, you did. What are you trying to tell somebody? You see, this is what I'm saying, and that's what we have to understand. We cannot go against the scripture. You cannot use Malachi against the new Christian church, which Jesus Christ have bought with his blood. And he said, the gates of hell shall not prevail. You know, I've listened to many eloquent people talk about this subject matter, and they try to make it eloquent and talk about worshiping God, and when God, you worship God. Yeah, you worship God, but according to the New Testament standard, we are no longer under law, but we are under grace. We worship God as we see fit before our God. I don't have any obligation to you to make me feel bad in the presence of the Lord to tell me that I'm robbing God. Who are you? You don't know about me and my God. Do you know what I do for God? Do you know what kind of relationship me and my Father have? How dare you tell me that I'm robbing God? And how come you dare go back to Malachi to tell me, as if I'm some Israel, to tell that I rob God? Who are you? You see, that is the distinction and declaration the believer in Christ have to make. You have to know that you know Jesus, that he have redeemed you, and you are washed because of Jesus, and you hold on to that. This is what it is. So we are able to develop a relationship with God. Because you see, brethren, what you have to understand is, if everybody have to babysit you and keep trying to tell you what to do for God, then you would never develop that confidence to know that you are hearing from God. That God told me to do that. I know it. I know he told me to do that today. Oh, I know he told me don't do that. Let me take care of that first. I know he told me that. You see, you have to come to a place, because you could say, look, you lose your apartment, and God is saying, well, I was saying to pay your rent. You agree to go and give your bishop. You agree. Go ahead. Lose your apartment. I don't care. And I'm not saying God say that, but the point I'm making to you, if you listen to your Father, he will say, all right, you take care of that. You handle that. You handle that. So you have a roof over your head. But you say, well, no, the bishop say I'm robbing God. So let me go ahead and pinch a little piece and give him. Well, give him. You give him and go ahead.
lose your apartment. And when you lose your apartment, go to them and see what they're going to do. Oh, Bishop, you know, I lost my apartment, you know. I tried to pay my tithes and everything, and, you know, things went from bad to worse. I wasn't working, and, you know. What can you do for us? Do you have anything in this storehouse? Well, girl, to tell you the truth, I'll have to get back to you, you know. And let me try to find out from sister this what they have over there and see if I can get back to you. Well, you know, to tell you the honest truth, you know, people not paying the tithes in this church and da da da. What? How many years have you been in existence? How many money do you collect a week? How much you pay for rent? How much for light? What is in this storehouse for the Lord? You see, somebody gonna have to answer to God on a day. Because everything in the scripture, let me show you something in Malachi. Let's go back there for a minute. You have your Bible with you? Let's go to your Bible for a minute. Malachi 3 and 4. Malachi 3 and 4. Let's look at this here. For any man who want to use God's word at their convenience, look at what he's saying here. Malachi 3, 4. Then shall the offering of Judah and Jerusalem be pleasant in the sight of the Lord, as in the days of old and as in former years. Listen. And I will come near to you to judgment, and I will be a swift witness against who? The sorcerers, against the adulterers, against the false swearers, against those that oppress the hireling in his wages, the widow and the fatherless, and that turn aside the stranger from his right, and fear not me, saith the Lord. So the stranger, his right is the blood of Christ. His right is to have a free course with his God, that he can come to the presence of the Lord and prostrate before God and say, Father, you know my heart. You know I'm not working, God, but I'm here to praise you. I'm here to thank you. Hallelujah. To tell that man that you better don't come back here if you don't have your tithes. Brother, hallelujah. You played with a lot of fire. You playing with God. I'm telling you. You see, you read the scripture and you're trying to take it to do what you want with it. But you're going to have a problem with God. Because it isn't to me. Read the scripture. He said, look. Let's go back to Malachi 3. Behold, I will send my messenger, and he shall prepare the way before me. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Listen to me. No man come to the Father best by me. Now, he said here in Malachi 3, we are ready before. Listen to me. Let's go back to 2. But who may abide the day of his coming? You see, before Jesus came, the men who controlled the temple, they had control over the people. But now, all control is by the Spirit of God. Now, he asking, let me see who will be able to stand when Jesus come with the Holy Spirit. Listen to that. Who may abide on the day of his coming? And who shall stand when he appeareth? For he is like a refiner's fire and a fuller's soap. And he shall sit as a refiner's fire and a purifier of silver, and he shall purify the sons of Levi. Well, we know that if we read the whole of Malachi, we know that they went so bad until God got rid of them. They were good, but they went so bad. So now God is saying they're going to be purified, and they'll be washed with soap. And they shall be purged as gold and silver, that they may offer. You see, even from here, he's telling you, they no longer will be under any stipulation or obligation, but now they will offer an offering in righteousness. That's why we present our body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto the Lord. That is between you and your God. You see what I'm saying? Hallelujah. Amen. Then shall the offering of Judah, you see, offering again. You see, you can't just take the scripture like that. Even from the Old Testament, God is making it clear that from the New Testament on, it will be all about an offering in righteousness. He's making it clear from the Old Testament. So if you want to read it with your eyes set on money and your eyes set the way you set, you will not see this because you're not reading for that. The Bible says the word of God is a discerner of the intention of the heart of a man. When a man reads the scripture with the intention, God will give you what you want, because that's what you want to do with it. If you want to tell people this, you will find every scripture to validate what you're saying. But God is saying it very clear for the man that is reading, very clear, because the God said, the word of God, there is no private interpretation. You understand me? He said, Lord, an offering in righteousness. And then the offering, you see, he made it clear again. He said, look, My son is coming. The messenger is coming to make the path before me, God Almighty. I'm sending Jesus. I'm no longer using mere mortal men. I'm sending Jesus. Jesus said, I must go, that I will send you the Comforter. When he come, he will lead you into all truth. It means the Comforter will tell you what you need to do. Don't do nothing here. Walk away. This place is not of God. Don't give a dollar. Just keep moving. Keep moving. You see, this is what God is hoping to get from people who are obedient to the Spirit of God. So those who are contrary to the doctrine of Jesus, they will have to close down or find some other means of existence. But God would not support it by his people if we are obedient to the Spirit of God. But many of these people are out there because people are not listening to the Spirit of God, and they become reprobate. They don't hear from God anymore. Hallelujah. Amen. He said, look at this. In 5, and I will come near to you to judgment, and I will be a swift witness against the sorcerers, against the adulterers, against the false swearers, and against those that oppress the hireling in his wages, the widow and the fatherless, and that turn aside the stranger from his right, and fear not me, saith the Lord of hosts. And in that scripture again, he said, you bring it in the storehouse that there will be meat in my house. So it means if the widow come for meat, if you collect it under that scripture, saying that you collect it under the guise of Malachi 3, you bring it that there will be meat in the storehouse, make sure you have meat in the storehouse. When the stranger come and the hireling come and the widow come, make sure that they can get something from the storehouse, because God will not be pleased with you. Because for years you've been collecting in the storehouse, and I want to know what happened to it. If it's in the storehouse, where is it? Is it in the bank? Where it is? Where it is? Where is it? Hallelujah. Amen. So the scripture is right before us, so we can choose to use it or not use it if we want. But all I'm trying to say to you, everything in the New Testament is an offering to God. It's an offering. Everybody offer their body a living sacrifice, and they offer whatever else they want to offer. It's an offering. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. We bless God. The phone is still open, brethren, if you're out there in radio land. And this young man said something concerning the speaking in the tongues there. Like I said, I'm not against all these things because I have experienced it. I know that speaking in tongues is something that is real. But I believe that God is the one that orchestrated, especially in the body of Christ. He told us, do not do it if you don't have an interpreter. You know, those of you who say, I don't care what you're saying, oh, we catch your spirit. Go and catch your spirit. When you reach before God, you're going to find out what's going on. I mean, I can tell you. You know your God. The same way everybody know your God, you know your God. But Paul said this is a commandment that is given to the Lord by the Lord. It's not me that is speaking to you. If you go in the congregation, let one speak, let two speak. And if one bring an interpretation, so be it. Otherwise, I forbid you not to prophesy. I tell you, prophesy. Seek to do those things. All the gifts of God, seek God for it. But seek him for the right reason. Seek it to do the right thing for God, that God will be glorified. Not for you to get a name, not for you to have a title, not for you to go somewhere and people say, oh my God, when she preach, oh God, when she speak, oh Lord, oh, I just love it. You see, that's the devil again. You see, let me say you something to you. You see the devil? The devil know the things that you have within you. And even if when you're born again, he will come back and tempt you in the same area that he know you have a weakness. You see, if you was a good organizer and you know to make money, or you were a person outgoing, he's going to come back and tempt you and say, come on, you're a child of God. You're smart, you know, you could do all these things to raise money. Come on, you could just tell them this to make some money. You know your mouth is sweet. You know you could tell them that. And then you say, well, I think I have a talent for that. Let me go and tell them something else. You see, and the devil will feed you from behind the scenes and bring you back into perdition, while you're claiming to be for Jesus. So that devil not going to stop. So the devil know many people, their desire all along is to be popular. They always wanted to be known. So even if they receive Jesus, that desire to be popular is still in them. So they will go even to the means to be popular with men. They don't care. The devil know the desire you have in your heart all along. And if he could use you on the other side, even after you got saved, he's going to come back and tempt you to get back in the flesh, to get back away from God and tempt you again. And we see that happening many times out there. That's why many people depart from the faith. You see, they was in the faith and they depart from the faith. That's why the Bible says in the last days some shall depart. They shall go away from the faith. Oh, glory to Jesus. Hallelujah. 27 minutes after 9, and I pray that none of us is going away from the faith. Amen. We're going to stay with Jesus, and we pray for one another in our weakness, that we see a man in a fault, we restore him. And that's what God is hoping, that we can all be restored, you know what I mean? And from time to time, my wife give me correction. What do you think I'm going to do? I have to take correction from my wife when she tells me something. Would I going to feel, oh, my wife can tell me nothing? God can use a donkey to talk if you want, to see if you are obedient to his word. Especially when somebody come to correct you with scripture, they're not correcting you with their mouth. They say, well, brother, da, 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 da. They tell you, no, brother, let's take a look at the scripture. Let's go into the word. And they take you here, and they give you one line, and they give you one precept, and they give you another line, and another precept. And you say, oh, yes, all right. Then you have to be willing to submit to God. And all of us have to be willing to say, Father, if your word say it, allow me to hear it. Allow me to see it. And there are many people who cannot hear the scripture. They don't care what, they will not hear it, because why? Their mind is made up for what they want to do. There are many people who know the scripture here. They know it. They understand it. They know they say that it's a new covenant. They understand it. But they have agreed to go along with their friends and what is popular with everybody else. And they will use it because why? They want to be known by everybody else. They want to be accepted among the beloved. They want to be accepted among their peers. We all pastor together. That's what we do. We all bishop. That's what we do. So I invite you to my church. You come to my church. You tell them the same thing. I tell them the same thing. These people here not giving enough money. You come here to my church and you talk about money. You take the scripture. Use it like, because I cannot do it. Because if I do it, they're going to think I'm trying to talk to them. So let's bring you from outside and say, oh, Bishop, you bring a beautiful word today. You know how long we needed that word? Yes. Because you tell him to preach about that. You told him, yes, that's what we have in this church. Talk about that today. And the bishop started to elaborate. Oh, the Lord told me today. You think you can't fool God? You can't fool God, brethren. You can't fool the Father. You can't fool the King. Hallelujah. He's going to expose you. He's going to expose us. Let's be right.
Lead me, oh blessed thought, oh words with heavenly comfort brought. Whate'er I do, where'er I be, still it is God's hands that leadeth me.
He leadeth me, he leadeth me,
by his own hands he leadeth me.
His faithful former I would be,
for by his hands he leadeth me. Sometimes mid scenes of deepest gloom, sometimes where Eden's bowers bloom.
Hallelujah. 31 minutes after 9.
Troubles.
It's Choice Radio, your life, your salvation, your choice. And like I said before, in terms of what we're talking about, making these illustrations, is about the way men use these things. That is really the core of the conversation. The way we utilize it to go against the people of God and beat them in the head and make them feel guilty and make them feel bad. That is the problem. That is the problem. Amen. So if, like I said, if you people want to do that and that's the way they feel comfortable and you say whatever and they want to do, oh, okay. But the point is, we cannot make it something that take away from the blood of Jesus. Take away that he had paid the price. You have been bought, brethren. The bill is paid in full. Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. This is important. You cannot deny the Son of Man. That's what I'm trying to tell you. You cannot deny the blood of Christ. I'm saying it, man, brethren. You need to understand. You cannot deny the Son of Man. That is what he paid it in full. This is what I'm talking about. You might not feel it because you don't understand what I'm saying. We're not talking, trying to talk against you. You cannot utilize that scripture against the people of God. This is what I'm saying. So some of you don't understand. You think I'm just talking about... No. You cannot go against the scripture. The Bible tells you don't kick against this prick. Jesus Christ have redeemed the people from the curse of the law, physical death, poverty, and sickness. Is that true? Yes or no? Well, yes. Yes, if he have redeemed them, let my people go that they can sacrifice before me. That's what the scripture say. Let my people go. Let my people go on. Is the same thing with Pharaoh. Let my people go that they can sacrifice to me. Let them go. Let them free. And this is what Jesus did. He brought liberty. And he wants a communication that is direct between he and his children through Jesus. So we cannot put any bondage, any yoke on the people. Don't care how nice you want to put it. Don't care how cute you want to sound. No! They cannot feel obligated. They cannot feel bound. They cannot feel burdened down. Jesus paid it all. That is what I'm trying to tell you. When the sinner man come from the street and he criticized the church because of the way they talk about these things. Brethren, you're wrong. You're wrong. You're wrong. You're wrong. You are wrong. You cannot get right with that. This is what is called iniquity. Iniquity is found in you. I never knew you. What you were doing was not right. Yes, you got some people saved. Yes, you heal a few people. Yes, in my name. But still, there was iniquity in you, brother. You lay on your bed at night and you manipulate my scriptures to put my people in bondage. I set them free. Me, my blood. Why would you turn people against me because of what you're doing? Why you do that for? I died for them. It's not you. I paid for them. I bought them. Brethren, you don't understand the depths of what I'm talking about. You don't understand it. Ephesians 1 and 7 said, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to his riches and grace. Mark 10:45 say, for even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. Oh, come on, brethren. Come on. That is what I'm talking about. And I'm saying, you out there in radio land, you cannot support this. You cannot. Because I'm telling you, the people on the street, they are talking. And they are talking. And they are so disgusted about going around people who call themselves godly. They said, I feel so burdened down. The lady told me, she said, she feels so sad for her mother. Her mother don't want to hear it. She still want to go to the church. She said, you know, I feel so sad for you. They make up she's not working anymore, and the way they put this thing in her face, like they're speaking right to her. Because what they feel, her daughters, she have children and they have money or they whatever, and they feel she have an obligation to them, and they're ponging in you. People, you can't do this thing. You cannot do this thing. That's what I'm saying, brethren. So if you don't understand what I'm saying, and you think I'm talking against this, I'm talking against that, we have to go to the scripture. We cannot diminish the blood of Jesus. We cannot belittle the Son of Man. You're going to be wrong. You will be wrong. You will be wrong, brother. You will be wrong, sister. If you agree against Jesus, you will be wrong. You can be as religious as you want. Hallelujah. You know, the Bible tells you one day is with the Lord as 1,000 years. God will sit and watch you do something for 50 years. And you tell yourself you're doing good. And when you get before him. And you see, what is dangerous about grace, the grace of God, is that under the law, when you did something, there were people who upheld the law and they were administrators of the law, and you were punished there and then. So you know that you got it right and you move on to the next level. Unfortunately, if the Holy Spirit of God is not able to catch you and convict you in time before you die, there is no coming back. There is no changing. There is no fixing. There is no exchanging. After you have done it and you move into glory, eternity, it's done. It's a finished deal. Because the Holy Spirit is the one that gives the law of Christ to you in your heart, that you are able to abide and abound in the things of the Lord. That when you come before God, you should be coming spirit-filled, ready by and justified by the Holy Spirit, by a life that you have lived that is not contrary to the scripture and the doctrine of Christ Jesus. And you have that confirmation that you did have a relationship with God, that he did know you, You did have a one-on-one relationship. That is what God wants of all those who believe in the Son of Man, that they know how to hear their Father, and their Father knows how to hear them. And all those who lead the people of God, we give them that liberty before Jesus. We don't put no burden on their backs. We don't put no weight on them. We don't put nothing and tell them, oh, Jesus said this. Oh, Jesus said this. No. We give them according to the scripture. And then God will bring the conviction to them in the heart. And they'll be able to conform to the will of the Father, which is in heaven. There are some people who have heard me talk about the scripture from Corinthians this morning. And they say, I don't care what he say. And they will read and say, I don't care what that scripture say. I will still do what I want to do. Because that's what we do in our church. That's the way we do it. I don't care what the scripture say. I know what I feel. Go ahead and do what you feel. And go against the scriptures of God. And see what's going to happen to you. Because everything God does, he does it in a timing. You know, when you're ignorant for a while, he leave you to do your stuff. You do it. And then he bring the information to you to see if you want the information. But if I say, no, I don't want no information. I'm good the way I am. Well, go ahead. The Bible says, when light come, you walk in the light. And as we give you the scriptures, you use the scriptures and see. Paul said, this is the commandment of the Lord, that this is the way he want his church to operate, with dignity and integrity. That when people come here, they walk away, they know they have been in the presence of the Lord, and God is among these people. There was integrity, there was dignity, there was respect, and there was adoration for Jesus, that he is Lord among them. No one exalted himself above the fray, above the throne of God. God was exalted in every application in the word of God, and they will walk away convinced that God is among us. But when they walk away and saying, what kind of foolishness is this with all these people? Especially when they come with a good intention and they come with a good heart. They didn't come to look for fault. They didn't come to criticize. But they came open, and God spoke to their heart and tell them, I am not in this place. It's a bunch of foolishness going on in there. They cannot deny what God has put in their spirit. That is why we cannot make any man hold anything against us when we don't present Jesus. If they don't want Jesus, they don't want Jesus. But we should not give them a reason to deny Jesus. You understand what I'm saying, brethren? Do you hear me, brethren? Hallelujah. Amen. 39 minutes on the other side of the hour of 40 minutes past 9 o'clock. It's Choice Radio, your life, your salvation, your choice. And there are some things that we speak about from time to time. You know, they really, you know, put you at bay and make you, you know, you feel a little, you know, uneasy about it. But that's the way life is. That's the way life is. You know, I was speaking to a young lady not recently, and I was asking her, I said, did you baptize and everything? And she told me, yes, I baptized. So I said, I went further. I said, as a baby or as a big woman? And she said, oh, well, you know, we already, you know, we did, we Catholic and thing. I say, well, I say, I understand, you know. I say, I understand what you're saying, but you remember Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist, right? Mm-hmm. And the Bible says, he that believeth and is baptized, you see. So if there is water, you should not resist water baptism. You see what I'm saying? Because he said, the scripture said, he that believeth and is baptized, this one shall be saved. Because we must immerse. It's a spiritual war that's going on. So everything Jesus have orchestrated, we have to do the same things too. It is required of us. And the commandment Jesus gave, those are what is important, you know, for us to give to the church. Washing the feet and the different things Jesus had done and say, do this after me, follow this, whatever. Those things that we're supposed to keep according to Jesus, not create our own thing and tell people. Because in the Bible, there is no way you see Jesus said, well, tell them that they curse. Let them know that they curse if they don't do this. That's your own thing. You pick up on yourself. You take the scripture and you put it out of proportion. As a matter of fact, in churches, you don't hear people say, well, make sure that you repent before God before you bring your offering. Make sure you have no ought against someone before you bring your offering. They don't care about that. They just want your offering. And Jesus said, if you have an ought against someone, get rid of it. So that would be the main important thing that any man mention in a church before you collect an offering for the Lord. Tell them, please, brethren, if you come into the Lord to give an offering, please seek the face of God for any ought you have against anyone. Because what he said, you're not going to bless it. He's not going to bless it. So imagine, I'm taking it from you. I don't care where you get it. I don't care what you do, but give it to me. What good would it be to me if I didn't ask God to cleanse me and wash me and make me whole, make me worthy before you, that I can now present this offering to you? that you can in turn bless me as I continue in my life, or I can be a blessing to somebody, you see. But they focus and make sure they want to tell you that you curse and you this and you that, and that's not Jesus. You know, some of you might be offended, I understand, but we can all go to God and repent before God. There's nothing wrong. Nobody's bigger than God. Nobody's bigger than the word of God. You know what I mean? It's the word of God. It's Jesus. It's God. You know, I've listened to many people articulate and talk about praising God and talking about this and talking about this, because the bigger they are in ministry, their desire is to really rake in more and more money. So their desire is that they really want to make sure everything that comes on money, they want to give it to you and tell you, oh, it's going to be a blessing to you, because if I tell you that, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. But it's contrary to the New Testament doctrine, because from the book of Acts, there is not even one application of that, of collecting tithes. There was not one application. So I hope I'm making myself clearer to you, that you understand where I'm going, where I'm coming from, what I'm saying. And if you're on the side of Jesus, you will be on the side of me, because the word of God is all that we have. We have nothing left. The only thing that is relevant is the word of God. And like I said, the things that we speak on Choice Radio, what is in my heart, we concern about the man that has the false idea or ideals about the Church of Christ and is staying away because of false proclaimers. You see, let me show you in Malachi here. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because of what? False swearers. You see, and I come near to you in judgment, and I will be a swift witness against the sorcerers. You see, those who do magic, all kind of thing to try to get people money and all kind of try to bewitch people. Sorcerers and against the adulterers, all right? They have other gods. And against the false swearers, you see? False swearers. You see, he's against the false swearers. Amen? And against those that oppress the hireling in his wages. And amen, the widows and the fatherless. So God is saying, I'm coming to you in judgment. Jesus is coming in judgment when he comes. Amen? By the Spirit of God. If you are not operating in the Spirit, he is coming to judge you who oppress the hireling. Amen? Hallelujah. Underpaying people, undercutting people, using people. Hallelujah. Amen? And all this kind of stuff. So he said he's coming to deal with you guys. All of you, he's going to deal with you. Yes, he's going to deal with you. That's what he's saying there. Amen? Hallelujah. Glory to the name of Jesus. 45 minutes past the 9 o'clock, and we bless God for you out there in Radio Land. Hope that you hope that your stomach is strong in the morning time, amen, as you listen to your Father, the Word of God. Hey, you know, man, you have to just love the Word of Jesus, and we have to learn to love Jesus according to the Word of God. I'm telling you, man, just love Jesus by the Word. Love him by the Word. Love him, love him, love him. Let every man be a liar. Let God be true. Let God be true. For some of you, what we're saying, it might not really hit home to you, whatever, a certain way. I understand. But we have to let God be God, because we must be mindful of the man that is not religious, that want Jesus, but not under man's condition. They want Jesus by the Spirit of God. You must care about that, brethren. You cannot just care about you and I alone. We have to care about the man outside. This is what the church have to concern about. Those that really want Jesus, but not according to religious men's religion and men's tradition and men's law and men's stipulation. This is what have to, brethren, you don't understand. This is what is important. Jesus have shed his blood already. That is what you have to understand. The bill has been paid for all humanity. What we have to do is roll out the red carpet and tell them, walk. Walk, come to Jesus. That is what we... Oh, come on. That's what we're saying. So everything we're saying, that's what we're saying. But if you're being so religious, oh, we're only talking about the time, we're talking about the time. You're not listening to the counsel of God. There is a way that seems right unto a man, but the Bible tells you in the end thereof, it will be destruction. It will be destruction. We must do it according to the word of God. We must do everything according to scripture and get confirmation from God. Hallelujah. God is not an author of confusion. We always say that. We like to talk about those scriptures. Oh, God is not. Yeah, you're right. You're right. He's not out of confusion. You're very right. You very right. He's not out of confusion. Because when the sinner man come and realize that he's confused because of what you're trying to tell him, that he knowing he is that is not in the scripture, you are making God a liar. And you are making God seem to be an out of confusion. Hallelujah. Jeremiah 31:31 is such a profound scripture. We use it all the time. God said, no man shall tell another man how to know the Lord, because he will know God. I don't know if you guys read these scriptures. No, God is saying you cannot tell a man how to worship his God, what to do with his God, because he and his God has a connection. He know his God, his God know his pocket, his God know his heart. You leave him alone, let him worship his God in the beauty of holiness. Otherwise the blood is going to be on your hand. And this is what the Bible is saying. And everybody need to repent before God today with his behavior. And let people come unto Jesus. And let God be glorified in our congregation. Hallelujah. Let God give us the increase. Because he is God of the increase. Everything comes from God. Hallelujah. Everything comes from Jesus. He is still the same Jesus. If we tell you our testimonies of God, hallelujah, glory to his mighty name. I'm going with Jesus all the way. And that has to be your declaration today. I'm going with Jesus all the way. I know what he has done for me. I know what he has done for me. Oh, hallelujah. Let me not one day turn back on my God. When I got saved, I could have followed many pools of people and go along with whatever they're going along with. Then guess what? I would have been the man for them. Oh, you're tuning in to listen to my brother. Oh, tuning in, my good friend. Oh, yes, yes, yes. Because I'm going along with whatever they want to go along with. I made up my mind. I'm going with Jesus. Hallelujah. And you have to make up the mind. I'm going with Jesus all the way. This world had been before. People have been given the oracle of God before to see what they're going to do with it. And they were all destroyed. Because they went back against the word of God. Hallelujah. When Noah was building this ark, and this always comes to my spirit, don't you believe that there was nobody in that land who believed in the God of heaven? Of course they did. Of course they did. And I believe there were people who even helped Noah and his sons bring wood to bring that ark. But imagine 1 year pass. No flood, no rain. 2 years, no rain, no flood. 5 years, no rain, no flood. 10 years, no rain, no flood. 20 years, no rain, no flood. 50 years, no rain, no flood. One morning a man wake up and say, look, Noah, let me tell you something. You is the kind of man, I like you a lot. I believe somehow you know God. But after 50 years, I saw my last two children raise up to be big men. And you're still here building this ark, talking about this God and this judgment and this rain. Something wrong with your head. Maybe you should start drinking some bush. Something wrong with you. And 75 years, they say, look at the old man down there still ponging board. He and his children. Look at them down there. What kind of people is this? And they went away. And they thought God was no longer there. And then the flood came. Oh, hallelujah. So that's what happened to now. Men feel that they and God has become so much a good friend. They're bosom buddies now. They can do what they want with the word of God. But I assure you, he is right here looking. You know what the Lord put in my spirit the other day, right? I was telling you that before, right? You see how they have this camera when they could see you on the phone and you're looking at them and talking, hey, how you doing? And you're showing them the picture where you at. Ha, 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 ha. The Bible says there is three on the earth that bear witness, and then three in heaven that bear witness, and they connect it together, and they see you, and they know what you're doing. The same technology. Hallelujah. That's why you say the word of God is a discerner of the intention of the man. So when you're reading the Bible also reading you. I'm telling you, yeah, the Bible know what you're thinking. He know what you're doing. He know what's in your mind. So he said, three bear witness in heaven and three bear witness on earth. Yes, they connected together. They're making connection here, there. So they see all that's going on. So they know the truth. They know everything. You can't hide from him. He know everything that's going on. It's amazing, right? I'm telling you. So God is in full control, brethren. Our King is in full control. If you're out there and you found Jesus to be your Lord and Savior, I want to encourage you to keep believing in Jesus and keep seeking a clearer connection with God and that new man in you. Don't be afraid to tell people, I'm born again. I'm a child of God. I don't do that no more. I don't talk that way anymore. I don't live so anymore, brother. I don't listen to that anymore. Let them know God will be proud of you. God will be proud of you, brethren. Let them know. Let them know. I know who I am in Christ. You can be falling down. You can be weak. But get up. Stand up with Jesus. Claim that salvation. Hold on to the arms of the altar. And let them know I'm not going back to this old world. I've been there before. I know about it. I'm not going back. I'm walking with Jesus. Whether I'm rich or whether I'm broke, I'm going on with Christ. I've been redeemed. What shall a man do? Hallelujah. What shall it profit a man to gain the world and lose his soul, brethren? I don't want to lose my soul. Hallelujah. 7 more minutes before the hour of 10 o'clock. We bless God. A few more minutes. The phone is open if you...
Jesus.
But we just thank God for liberation in Christ. Hallelujah.
Believe in me. Oh, blessed thought. Oh, words with heavenly comfort brought. Whate'er I do, where'er I be, still it is God's hands that leadeth me.
He leadeth me, He leadeth me.
By His own hands He leadeth me.
His faithful follower I would be,
for by His hands He leadeth me. Sometimes mid scenes of deepest gloom, sometimes where Eden's bowers bloom, by water still or troubled sea, still it is God's hands.
6 more minutes. One or two more calls in the segment. We bless God for you.
By His own hands
He leadeth me.
He leadeth me. Lord, I would clasp Thine hand in mine. I'll never murmur nor repine, content whatever, Lord, I see. Still it is God's hands that lead.
Hallelujah.
He leadeth me. He leadeth me.
By His Hallelujah. Own hands
He leadeth me.
His faithful follower I would be,
for by His hands
He leadeth me.
And when my task on earth is done, when by Thy grace the victory is won, if death go away, I will not flee, since but through Jordan He leadeth me.
He leadeth me.
He leadeth me.
By His own hands
He leadeth me.
His faithful Hallelujah.
Three, 4, 7, 6, 6, 3, 8, 6, 3, 8. We have time for one or two more calls in the segment. One more call. Before we shut down the segment, we want to thank you so much. We really appreciate all the listeners who listen to Church Radio. And we pray God, it's all about the Word of God, brethren. It's all about the Bible. We're not telling you we know the whole scriptures. But by the Spirit of God, we are not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Thank you, Lord. Lead us, Father.
By His own hands, He
And I encourage you to go back and read Genesis 1. Start from Genesis. Start reading the Bible all over. And just create, cultivate a picture in your mind of the world that God created. And to know that He is in full control. Read Genesis 1 again. Just read it again. Read it again. A brand new heart. Just read Genesis 1. Hallelujah. Read Genesis 1. Read the Bible. And look at your Father. Amen. And you know, coming into Christ, like I said, I always say that. There are many things I hear people said before when I got saved, and I just cannot register it in my spirit. I don't receive it, and I don't know why I'm not receiving it until later on I get confirmation as to why I'm not receiving it, because it's contrary to scripture. It's contrary to God's creation. It's contrary to what God says He created and why He, who He is and what is going on. So there are times I don't receive certain things. I hear it, it just go over my head, or it hit me like, it really, out of everything, it just stick right there, like that particular word or that particular statement, just, oh, no, something wrong about it. I have to find out, oh, why is that wrong? Let me see that, And then you get clarity as to why you didn't receive it, you know what I mean? After a while, certain things you don't receive, then you know, hey, something is going wrong. Because we should be feeding on the Word of God every day, food, manna, new wine, new food. The more we eat the Word of God, new revelation. And when we stop getting revelation, something is wrong. You have to find out why. You're not hearing in the realm of the spirit. You have to find out. And that's something that people don't pay attention to. If you grieve the Holy Spirit of God, and you have the power, and you know God, and yet for all you agree to go against the word, you become a reprobate. You'll be groping around and saying, what did the scripture say again? What did the scripture say again? And you don't understand. But He's saying the same thing to you. And I believe we have to take God at His word. He said He's going to give over some people to reprobate mind. You have to believe it. There are many people that is reprobate. They read scriptures, they quote scriptures, but they're reprobate. They can't hear the God again. God is not talking to them. I know you don't want to believe that, but that's what the scripture said. He gave them over to be a reprobate, that they may do what is unseemly, what is unright. He gave them over. You don't believe that? Yes, He gave you over. Yeah, you know better. You want to do wrong? Do wrong. You want to do that? Do that. No problem, because we all have a free will to serve God. You know what I mean? What a father, eh? What a father. You out there in Radio Land today, if you have never given your heart to Jesus, you hear us on the program talking about God, talking about Jesus. You believe there is a God. You believe it. You believe it. But there are people in your life that you see who claim to know Him, that live totally contrary to what you know in your spirit represent the God of heaven. And that have kept you on the fence. That have kept you away from your Father. Your Father is saying, no. Someone died for you that you don't have to go to hell. All you have to do is receive the gift and read my word, and I'll be your God. Oh, brethren, I was telling a guy yesterday, we have a big, I call it argument, you know, because, you know, God making me these people sometimes and, you know, listen to them. And he was talking a lot of stuff, and I say, my brother, God is not about this and that. God is about you and Him. And first of all, to come to God or to understand God's words, you must believe that He is, because he was saying he don't believe in the virgin birth, everything came from seed. I say, do you believe God created the heaven and earth? Yes. Do you believe He created water? Yes. Do you give it? Yes. So why you don't believe He could make somebody make a child without? Well, everything came from seed. He go back to the same first conversation. I said, I understand what you said. Everything came from seed, right? Yes. Do you believe God is God? Yes. You believe He made the sun? Yes. He made the moon? Yes. He made a man from dust? Yes. What if He made a man from nothing? How could He not make a man from... I'm just saying, you know. So this is what we have to deal with from a daily basis. But the thing about it is, like, say, all of us have a duty to God to represent Him, that men will know that He is real, and we have to try our best, not by our might, but by the Spirit of God, to lift up Jesus in whatever we do, that men can truly believe in our God. Amen. Father, we bless you, we thank you, and we praise you for this great opportunity. I thank you for my life today. I thank you for my wife. I thank you for all those that you have put in our circle, in our circuit, Father, to help us, to feed us, to encourage us, to keep lifting up your word. And we thank you for everyone that is able to encounter this broadcast as you orchestrate it, because you said you will never leave us nor forsake us. You will make a way out of no way, and you will always try to enlighten your people to know your truth that we can all together be in the faith of Jesus. So Father, we thank you for that person who will give their life to you today. That person will repent from contrary notions concerning your word today, Father. We pray for that leader who will understand what it is that was dispensed in today, or what is it we were trying to say, that we cannot allow the people who want the bread of life to feel that they are obligated, that they owe God something, to eat the bread that was freely given. Father, we pray that mankind will understand that there is a way that seemeth right unto every man, and in the end thereof is judgment according to your decrees, Father. And we bless you for our people today, our brethren, our sisters, our mothers and sisters, our grandmothers, and whoever it is, Lord, our deacons, our bishops, whoever it is that listen today, God. Father, we pray that that word will germinate in their heart, and let them understand that the price that was paid on Calvary is such an important price that was paid, that every man needs to have access to the throne of God through Jesus. So, Father, that man or woman today that will give their life and make this confirmation today and make this declaration, Father, I pray that you will visit them and encourage them that you are interested in their life just as everybody else. So if you're out there and you're that person today making that declaration, say this prayer after me and mean it from the bottom of your heart. Serving God is a hard decision. When you're making that decision, you have to see yourself in the future walking as a new man, living as a new man, as the Spirit of God continue to give you utterance and give you liberty in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let's say this prayer now. Dear God, I admit that I am a sinner and I need your forgiveness. I believe that Jesus Christ died in my place, paying the penalty for my sins. I am willing right now to turn from my sins and to accept Jesus Christ as my personal Savior and Lord. I commit myself to you and ask you to send the Holy Spirit into my life to fill me and to take control and to help me become the kind of person that you want me to be. And I thank you, Father, for loving me. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Brother, if you have said that prayer, hallelujah. Thank God for you. If you have said that prayer today, you have given your heart to Jesus. Start reading your Bible. Start reading your Bible. Start speaking to your God like he's a real person, because he is a real person. You talk to your God. That's you and your Father. Tell him all your secrets. Tell him. He know it already, but tell him that you don't want it. You don't want to be a part of that old man. Tell him. He know, but tell him. Talk to your Father. That is your Father. That is your Father. He's nobody's business. That's you and your God. This is you and your God. If you want to cry, cry before your God. Let him know what you did was wrong. Let him understand that you really didn't know you were doing so bad. Let him know that's your Father. This is your Father. Speak to him and allow him to cultivate your heart and bring you to a new place in him. That's just between you and your God. Just between you and your God. Hallelujah. Ask God to lead you to a Bible-believing church where you can grow in the Word of God. And whenever you go there, you'll be always filled and filled and filled, more and more filled in the Word of God. That when you step out of the presence of the Lord, you are willing to give what you got. Exchange, share with somebody, that they too might enjoy the fullness of joy in Christ. Amen. We bless God for you. Thank you so much, brethren, out there in Radio Land. Hallelujah. Those on the jobs, good morning. Thank you so much.
I'm going with Jesus.
Have you decided to go with Jesus? Hey, I'm going to give you one more scripture before I shut down this segment. Definitely, indeed. As we look at the Word of God and see how God has everything structured in there. Now, there's a crucial scripture here in the book of Luke. Luke 22 and 25. He said unto them, The kings of the Gentiles, hallelujah, exercise lordship over them. And they that exercise authority upon them are called benefactors. But ye shall not be so. But he that is great is among you, let him be as the younger, and he that is chief as he that doeth serve. For whether is greater, he that sitteth at meat or he that serveth? Is not he that sitteth at meat? But I am among you as he that serveth. Ye are they which have continued with me in my temptation. And I appoint unto you a kingdom, as my Father had appointed unto me. Have you read that scripture? Have you read that scripture? With all that we're talking about today, have you read that scripture? Read it again. Luke 22:25. And he said unto them, the kings of the Gentiles, pagans, yes, unbelievers, wicked men, the kings of the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and they that exercise authority upon them are called benefactors. Yes, Word of God, benefactors. Isn't that the way they're running churches now? Yes, yes, father and son, mom and pop shop, right? Yes, yes. Of course. Yes, yes, yes. Well, we're going to leave it right there in the name of Jesus. Father, we bless you. You are King of all kings, Lord of lords, Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. Lord, you know our infirmities. You know our weakness. You know everything that we do it unto you for your honor and your glory. You said if we lift your Father, you will draw all men. Hallelujah. And we pray that we have not exalted ourselves above your means by any way. And we pray that we have, you know, executed the word with dignity and humility and you know, without any prideful spirit. And we humble before you today, before your people. And we pray that we all will come in the unity of the faith, in the love of Christ, knowing what he have done was accepted by you. Oh, hallelujah to your name, Jesus. We believe the price was paid in full, Father. We believe it. We believe we were redeemed. We thank you, Jesus. So, Father, thank you for having your way with us. The final scripture is taken from Galatians 5 and 16. The Bible said, this I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary one to the other, so that he cannot do the things that he would. But if ye be led
of the Spirit. You are no longer under the law. Now, the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envy, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like. Of the which I tell you before, as I've also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not be desirous of vain glory, provoking one another, envying one another. Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. Bear ye one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. For if a man think himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceiveth his own self. But let every man prove his own work, and then shall he have rejoicing in himself alone, and not in another. For every man shall bear his own burden. Let him that is taught in the word communicate unto him that teacheth in all good things. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. And let us not be weary in well doing, for in due season we shall reap, if we faint not. As we therefore have opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially unto them who are of the household of faith. Hallelujah. Bless God. So guys, be blessed of the Lord. We thank you so much for your prayers. Thank you for listening. Many stations, many sources of music and talking about God. And we thank you. And we always say we come before you humbly. Every day we pray, God, let my voice be sweet. Let my voice be nice. You make it the way you want to make it, because you know who listens to the radio. You know. You make it right. And we pray that we submit our will to you, that you can work through us, that we all can be strengthened in your word. We all can be strengthened before you as Almighty God. You know, that's all it is. You God and you God alone. And, you know, we want to just be able to come before you and always see you as the ultimate God, that none of us will never become close to that. We always want to be below and look up to you as God and Creator. Father, we bless you. I thank you for my wife today. Thank you for all the family of God. Thank you for all the brethren who listen to this program and is praying for us. We pray that you understand what we're trying to do as we lift up the name that is above every name, Jesus. That is the one who have saved me. This is the one who have saved me. This is the one who have called me from darkness to light. I will lift up his name. I will worship him. I will praise him. What he put in my lips, I will utter to you, as I always ask him for wisdom. You give me wisdom that I can walk before you, that I can honor you, God. Amen. That's what we all need. God gave us wisdom that we're going to be right. We're able to get away from the trap of the enemy that doesn't want us to inherit the kingdom. Hallelujah. Every one of us, every day we ask him for wisdom that we can walk before him quietly. Quietly before God. Quietly, brethren. Quietly. God Almighty. Yes. King of all kings. Lord of all lords. Thank you. Hallelujah.
I'm ready.
Be blessed of the Lord, brethren. Have a good day.
Would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood, power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood.
Power, wonder working power in the blood. Precious blood of the Lamb.
Would you be free from your passion and crime? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's time. There's wonderful power in the blood. You do service for Jesus, your King. There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily His praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. Oh, there's power, wonder-working power in the blood. In the blood of the Lamb. Power, power, wonder-working power. In the precious blood.
Every true believer in Jesus Christ needs a source of information and encouragement. So, download the Choice Gospel Radio app on your smartphone or dial 213-493-0146 to listen anywhere. Choice Gospel Radio app has six channels to choose from: the Choice Radio channel, the Choice News channel, the Choice Youth channel, the Choice Word channel, the Choice Praise channel, and the Choice Spanish channel. Download it now and share it with someone. Choice Radio, your life, your salvation, your choice.
This is Choice Radio. We're not about religion, only...
Victory win. There is wonderful power in the blood.